Truth is never the student of lies. Truth is never the student of lies, okay? This is very profound, and we will make this our anchor here. Truth is never the student of lies. What we try to do, we're going against the current of the belief in this world. We make very strong effort to make some progress, then we anchor. We put an anchor down. We know where to get that anchor. Truth is never the student of lies. What this world is going towards is a situation where they're trying to make truth the student of lies. So they have lies as the teachers, and we're supposed to, as those who want truth, we're supposed to be the student of lies. So we must reject this, absolutely reject this, and say truth is never the student of lies. Now, they will come back at us, this false belief system that we're, that is pressuring us. But it's enough to keep hearing this, keep reinforcing this. We know we're in the right. Truth is never the student of lies. Now, the teacher that we have is truth. Jesus is a teacher of truth, and Jesus has students. I'm one of Jesus' students. The students are not greater than the teacher, but the students, if they learn the lessons perfectly, will be equal to the teacher. So I'm striving to learn the lessons perfectly. And in the meantime, part of this striving is to make these videos and to teach the lessons. Truth is never the student of lies. Now, this is more profound than we realize. This is, very crucial, because this is ultimately what this society, what this culture is doing. This is what they're up to. This is a little play. This world is like a little stage, and we're playing a little play on it. And this little play is attempt to, for spirit to create another authority other than the one authority, which is God. There's only one authority. We talk about oneness, means there's just one authority. There's not two authorities. There's just one, and that one authority is the sole authority. That one will. There's only one will. That one will is the will of God. There's not two wills. What we're trying to do is we're trying to say that there's another will. And we play this little game, and we're using bodies and genders, male, female bodies, to play out this little game. And the ultimate goal is to place this authority over us. That's our purpose of this game, to say that there's some will that's greater than God. Okay. So we have a plan that we're following. This little play goes as three-part play, and so first it starts out by saying, "Well, there is this other authority separate from God, but it's inferior." You start out that way. Say, "Ah, don't worry, God. Yeah, there is this will that's other than yours, but it's not as strong. It's subordinate to you. It's subordinate, right? So you should be happy with that." Of course, this is a lie. There's no will that's subordinate to God. There's only one will. There's not God's will and then a subordinate will. There's only one will. So how do we play this out? We can look at the little play we've done in history here, and the play has lasted, thousands of years here, which is just a little snap of the fingers, really. And we start out by saying that men represent the will of God and that females represent this other will. Okay, that's subordinate. That's subordinate. And we say, "Oh, don't worry, God." We act this out, male and female, and the female says, "Oh, don't worry, male. I'm subordinate to you. You don't have to worry about me. Your will is way more powerful than mine." Okay, so this is how we act this out. This is a spiritual drama we're acting out using male and female personas as actresses and actors and actresses. Then we introduce the idea of unfairness. We say, "Hey, wait a minute. It's not really fair that there be one will stronger than the other." So, you know what? We realize that the ultimate outcome, to be fair and to be happy, and fairness means happiness. We say we can't be happy unless we're fair. of course, dreaming that there's some will other than God's is unhappiness. But we forget about that. We say, no, happiness can be found by making the wills equal. So then we promote this equality of women, okay, in this play we're doing. But, oh my gosh, we said this is terrible inequality. We must have equal will. So first there was, you know, one will that is superior and the other will subordinate to that will. And now we say, no, equal will. So there's this will of God and then the will of the other will that is, and we act this out by male and female. So now we have equality, we think we have equality. But then a funny thing happens, right? Because the whole purpose of this is to claim that there's some, that spirit can create a higher will than God. So what we get is we say, hey, wait a minute, I'm still not happy. And so I've had this, I wasn't happy when the will was subordinate, one will was subordinate to the other. I wasn't happy when the wills were equal. So the only place that happiness can be must be that this other will is now superior. And the other now, it, and then the first will, the one that was superior, is now subordinate. So then what you have then is the female will is then raised into a superior, dominant position, and the male will is now subordinate to that. And so here we play out this little play of the idea of reversing the direction of creation, that there's some separate will other than God that reverses the whole thing, and now God's will is completely subordinate to this other will. And so this is the desire that spirit has, this game it wants to play. It wants to be superior to God. It says there's a superior will, some separate will that comes in as superior. And of course this is just spirit wanting to be greater than God, pretending that this can be possible. And it plays this little game out, like first this will, the separate will subordinate, then it's equal, and then it's superior. And so we have seen very clearly in this little game we call history, what we're playing out in existence, is exactly what's happened. This is exactly the game we're playing. Now the truth is that there's only one will. That's God's will. And so there isn't anyway. Let us not go too fast. That's a little too fast. We just have to let this settle in. Like, wow, this is the game we've been playing. Wow. I can feel a wow there. Okay, so I realize that and say, okay, let me just stop here. Let this sink in because it's very profound. Now, I've seen this all along, and I've been preaching this my whole life. I said, hey, look, this game we're playing is to make truth subordinate to lies, to make truth the student of lies. This idea that there's some separate will, other will, is a lie. Okay, and we're saying the only way we can be happy is if truth is now the pupil, the student of lies. And we are acting this out to make it seem real to us, as it were, make it seem substantial. Because in spirit, it's insubstantial. We say, oh, this is nothing. This can all vanish in just a brief moment of recognition. Whereas if we have all these props and bodies and world, it doesn't seem so easy to make it vanish in an instant. See, so it makes it seem like it's got time to it. It's got substantiality to it. This is why we act it out. But I warned, I said, this is what's going to happen. You wait and see. First they'll say fairness, fairness, equality, equality, equality. But that is just one step towards dominance. And now the dominance is most certainly here. Most certainly here. Extreme dominance, where this culture is going is to make truth the student of lies. And then men are supposed to act out this role of being of truth, the will of God, which is now needing to learn from lies that it, the will of God, is actually no will at all. Ultimately, the goal is to say that God's will isn't even will at all, and to become completely enslaved into a like a queen bee hive sort of thing, where the queen bee just completely rules the hive, and the males are just drones to die, you know, to die in battle, to expand the queen's territory. So this is a silly little game that we're playing. There's only one will. It's God. And we use the term God the Father here just in this play to emphasize that God is formless, has no flesh, is formless idea and essence, not even energy, not electromagnetic energy, no. Form is essence. And so the term, the mother, the female, automatically the implication is that it's flesh, that it's form, that it's energy, the dance of energy, all this. So we have to emphasize it's God the Father, not God the Mother. And when we play the silly game of saying, well, it's God the Father, Mother, what are we doing? We're trying to make this other will equal to God. Saying, hey, it's not fair. There's this other will. You can't say that there's only one will. So we'll say God the Father, Mother. There's a sure sign of this egoic game. When people speak like God the Father, Mother, that's a sign of the egoic game that's being played here. So that's called going horizontal. And we're not a party to that at all. Go vertical, entirely vertical, is the only way to escape this diabolical play, which is designed to get the will of God, which is the only will there is, as a student of lies, and then as a student of lies to learn the lessons that lies are teaching, which is to say, you have no will at all. There is no will of God at all. So we unabashedly and unapologetically say God the Father, okay? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And this pragmatically puts us back on the vertical, okay, of just one will. We're not being spread out into lessons of this play of, you know, flipping the tables on God's will. We're not going horizontal at all. We're staying vertical, which means one decision, and we're out of the horizontal entirely. When you try to make this all spread out in the time, space, process, and form, it seems so substantial. We think, well, we have to go through all these processes to get free. Well, the truth is, no, they're just a simple decision that we're not going to play this idiotic game anymore, and we're free of it. This is called going vertical. So we put the shoe on the other foot and say those who are insisting on what they claim to be as equality and God the Father, Mother, and then what they eventually say is God the Mother, Father, and then eventually say, no, just God the Mother. This is what they're doing. Why are they so embarrassed? Why are you so embarrassed to say God the Father? Why are you so embarrassed? There isn't any other will. There's only one will. So anyone who's playing this game of equality, they're automatically assuming there's two wills. Automatically. Anyone who says the term fairness is automatically assuming there's two wills, right? Because if there's only one will, how can the concept of fairness even arise? It's impossible, isn't it? Consider that well. The issue of saying fairness, how can fairness arise unless there's two wills? You say, I need to be fair to this one, I need to be fair to this other one. If there's only one will, how can you not be fair to it? I mean, there's nothing to be unfair to. Fairness means, well, if I'm not fair to this, you know, I can be unfair to this and fair to this. It means two-ness. Fairness means two-ness, inherently. If there's only one will, we don't have any option. It inherently is what it is. It is fair, because there's nothing to be unfair to. So all this rhetoric, when we hear fairness, it means two-ness. It means two wills. So again, first they say, well, God the Father, but with there's a mother of God, but mother of God's not as great as God, you know. And then they say, wait, that's not fair. So they say, God the Father, Mother. And they say, okay, we got equality there. And they say, no, wait a minute. That doesn't sound right. Say, no, it's God the Mother, Father. They say, oh, okay, God the Mother, Father. And then they end up saying, just God the Mother, which means God, time, space, process, form. God, mean this other, the lies are now true. Lies are now the will, the only will there is. The will of God has disappeared. So we're just acting out this stupid, silly, whimsical game here in this world. And those who see it realize it, just what's going on. Just said this is just completely absurd. Total absurdity, total waste. There's only one will, God the Father. That's it. God the Son did not establish the will of God at all. So when God the Son thinks that it wants to play the game, that it established the will of God, then it goes into this silly, silly little play that we're very familiar with, unfortunately now, right? So it's enough to not judge against truth. And so that's what we're doing here. We're hearing this, and we're just saying, wow. Right? There's no reaction other than just wow. So when I say this, I don't really have any reaction except wow. This is true. Obviously, what's being said is true. We know it is. But we don't try to judge for it, because as soon as we try to judge for it, we're thrown into the judgmental state of mind, which then is about fairness. Easily, it becomes about fairness. And as soon as we are about fairness, we're about two-ness. Right? And as soon as we're about two-ness, then we're not aware that our intrinsic nature is happiness. There's only oneness. There's only one will, and that we're perfectly happy with that. And therefore, we think that we have to find some way to be happy. And then we say, well, but subordinate, having this will, subordinate, we're not happy. Having an equal, not happy. Therefore, the only place to go is to make it dominant. That we're submissive to this other will. And we think, well, we haven't tried that, so we have to try that to be happy. But there's only one will, and our one will is happy, you see. This is what we have to realize and accept. We don't need to do anything to make ourselves happy. This is crucial. We don't need to go horizontal. Horizontal means we're making efforts to make ourselves happy, to do something. We don't need to do anything. We are intrinsically happy. The one will of God is intrinsically happy. So do not go into judgment. Just hear it and just say, wow. That's it. Just feel this wow. Shocker, isn't it? I'm shocked. I'm stunned. This wow. Don't judge for it. As soon as you judge for it, the idea is that you can judge against it too. How can we judge against the will of God? Is there some other will to judge for? No. There isn't. There's no issue of fairness at all. There's no issue of balance at all. There's not God the Father, God the Mother, and we have to balance. There's not two gods, there's not two wills. We have to balance the wills. There's no yin-yang to God's will at all. There's only one seamless, perfect will. And of course, this whole thing and this drama in the world now is we're at the point now where we're supposed, where those who advocate truth are supposed to be the students of lies, of liars, of lies. And the teachers in the world that are ascendant, you know, the ones that, I'm not talking about some of the valid spiritual teachers, obviously, but I'm talking about the cultural teachers, the ones that are gaining so much influence and power in the world, you know, those are the ones that are teaching lies. And they expect those who believe in truth and want truth to be the students of the lies, and they're expected to learn the lessons of lies, plain and simple. And they say that's the only way they can be happy. Who can be happy? Well, they say, well, I can be happy. Well, there is no I. There is no other will. The I refers to this other, supposed other will. There isn't any other will. A figment of our imagination. A whim is not a will. A whim is not a will. So to say, there's no I, so why do we need what doesn't exist to be happy? We don't. That's ridiculous. Why do we need some separate will to be a separate will? Obviously, we're saying, well, if this I doesn't have a separate will, a will, how can it be happy? Well, if it doesn't have a will, it doesn't exist. So why do we need to worry about the happiness of what is non-existent? The happiness of zero. Why should we worry? You know, is it our job to make zero happy? Hardly. Is it the will of God to make zero happy, non-existent? Is it the will of God to make some non-existent will happy? No. So how is the will of God unhappy when it knows that it doesn't have to be unhappy? It's like we're saying that we can't be happy unless we're unhappy. This is what we're really saying, that we can't find happiness unless we're unhappy. Now, let us just hear this. This is what we're telling ourselves, that the way to happiness is to be unhappy. This is called insanity. So, this full stop in the wow, the reaction is just like, wow. Now, don't go to uh-oh. If you've gone uh-oh, you've gone too far. See, you're not practicing in the right way. So, instead of uh-oh, you go to wow. It's a different thing. You go from glass half empty to glass half full. It's like that. And you say, well, there's not a big difference. Yeah, but it's a crucial difference. Very crucial difference. Because when you go, uh-oh, you're on the defensive, and you go into judgment. Whereas if you go, wow, you're not on the defensive, you're not going into judgment. You don't need to judge. You already made the one judgment that it's wow. This is the final judgment, is I don't need any judgment. Truth doesn't need any judgment. There's only one will. We don't need to judge between two wills, which one is better. There isn't any two wills. So how can we judge between just one? Where's their judgment? This is very crucial. So when we go, wow, we're making the one judgment we need, and that is, there isn't any need for judgment. There's only one will. Wow. I can set judgment down. Wow. The glass is half full. Yeah, meaning I can set judgment down. Or when we say the glass is half down, we say, uh-oh. Saying, how can I judge? How am I going to be able to judge? We say, uh-oh, I might have trouble judging. This implies two wills, and then we get on the defensive. So that doesn't work. It doesn't work. So what we do is we make the one judgment, which is, I don't need judgment. Wow. And that's the glass is half full now. See? We flip the script just like that. So this is the difference between effective practice and ineffective practice. So what we're doing here is effective practice. The reason why so many have not succeeded is they've been doing ineffective practice. They've been using judgment. They've judged that they need to use judgment, that they have to choose between two wills. There is no such choice to make. We don't have to make any choice at all. That's the final choice, is that I choose to accept that I don't need to make a choice. There's only one will. Now, when we see it that way, then lies don't exist. It's not like we need to choose between truth and lies, actually. I know Jesus says choose once again, but the choice is to see that there isn't any choice. We can choose to recognize that there isn't any choice. There aren't two wills. So how can we choose? There isn't any choice. The choice is to accept that there isn't any choice. So we can either choose to remain insane, or remain involved with insanity, or to accept sanity. That you could say that's the choice. When we go vertical, we mean there's no choice, right? Horizontal means this side and this side. That's the horizontal. I mean, here's the will of God and here's the other will. And we're trying to judge between the two. Like a cross. There's the main upright and there's a cross beam. The upright's the vertical, the cross beam's the horizontal. When we go vertical, it means we realize there is no choice. I choose to realize there is no choice. I choose to accept there is no choice. Now we can either accept or reject it, but truth is not dependent on our acceptance or rejection. You see, and this is what we realize. As long as we're rejecting it, we're just fearful. Okay, but truth is still true. Truth is still true. So going vertical means we choose to accept that there is no choice. I choose to accept that I have no choice. That's called going vertical. And going horizontal is the insistence that we have a choice. So this is the difference between truth and lies. So we don't need to choose between truth and lies, really, because lies, the choice is to realize that there is no choice. So there's nothing to lies. Lies is zero. And zero is not really a choice. We can't really choose between zero and everything. Because zero, there's nothing there. So there is no choice, actually. So we don't overcome lies by making lies true and then overcoming them. We just say that there isn't anything there to choose. There isn't any other will at all. And we call this going vertical. And I've expressed this in other videos, and we're re-emphasizing it now. Because to stay vertical you can be enlightened even in this world. Enlightened means staying vertical and not going horizontal. The world is frantically trying to make us go horizontal, which is why it's so difficult to stay vertical here. I mean, the demands are just, is it difficult? Well, I mean, we have to do it. So it really doesn't matter how we characterize it. We have to do it one way or the other. There's no option. We either go vertical or horizontal. You can't do both. You cannot do both. Because one says there's a choice, the other says there's no choice. How can you do both? You cannot. And the world is saying, well, of course there's a choice. Look at how substantial it is. You mean if there's no choice, then there's no substantiality to this world at all. You'd see it as insubstantial, really. Well, it is insubstantial, and we can see it that way. We're told by those who have gone vertical that the whole world appears to be totally flimsy and insubstantial. There's no real substantiveness to it at all. Try saying that. Substantive. Once is enough. Substantiveness. Substantive. substantiveness. No, substantiveness. There you go. If you can say that, you can go vertical. This is very substantive, and it has substantiveness. There's no substantiveness to the world. So I say, even something that difficult, we can do it. So we can go vertical. If you can say substantiveness, substantiveness. Substantiveness. Five, substantiveness. Go vertical. But they say, well, we're not helping people choose. We're not being helpful. No, we're being helpful by helping them realize, by witnessing to that there is no choice. That's how we're helpful. They say, well, you're not being fair. Well, we're saying that there is no fairness because there is no choice. There's only one. How can the issue of fairness arise at all? There's no such thing as fairness. And so, well, you're attacking. Well, how can we attack if fairness is not an issue at all? It's ridiculous. So, well, you're supporting one over the other. How can we support one over the other when there is no choice? So, well, you're choosing this, but how come you're not choosing this? There is no choice. So how can you say that I'm choosing one over the other? It's ridiculous. It's not like you say, well, you're choosing God over, you know, the mother or something. There is no. There's only God. There isn't God and the mother. All right? There's only one will. There's not the will of God and the will of God the mother. Well, the will of the mother. There's only one will. And they say, well, you're going into some terrible state. There's no state. There's just vertical realization. There's only one will, which is happiness, freedom. This is not some reduction of the two into one. There's only the one. It's not making the two choices into one. It's not making the two wills into one. There's always only been one will. It's not some reduction ad absurdum into, you know, these two wills, and somehow we combined the two and it reduced them into, you know. No, there's no reduction taking place. There's no contraction taking place. There's no triumph taking place. There's no defeat taking place. As soon as you think that way, you're horizontal. And you're lost. In delusion. So the whole thing about teachers in this world, they have to stay vertical. And this, the whole world, the sport of the world is to, you know, knock the vertical into the horizontal. That's the sport of the world. But when you realize what the teacher's really about, then you get sober and say, hey, wait a minute. This is tremendous. Let's not turn this into a sport here. This is not a sport. It's not a game. It's not a game here at all. There's not some winner and a loser. No. There's not even a, you know, there's not winner or loser. Now, when we speak conceptually, it automatically seems we're speaking in dualistic category ways, right? But we give the benefit of the doubt. We say the glass is half full. When you say the glass is half full, and your just reaction is wow, instead of, hey, wait a minute, how come you use this? That you, it sounds like you're winning, and then you're defeating, and that means there's a loser, so it means you're contradicting yourself. As soon as you do that, you're in judgment, glass half empty mode, and you're trying to go horizontal, and you're not practicing effectively. This is just a fact. So it's just wow. When you hear this, just wow, wow. Because you know it's true. When you hear a teacher of God, is wow. Because what they're doing, they're speaking truth. And so what you do is to avoid judging against it, you also avoid judging for it. You just say, wow. Okay, I'm just going to sit here in the wow. I don't need to do any more than that. So I'm certainly feeling the wow as I'm saying this. It's very powerful. Now this wow eventually expands into happiness, into bliss. But don't try to make it expand, because then you're back into judgment, trying to be judgmental for truth, which being judgmental, it's almost inevitable you go horizontal when you're in that mode. Like, oh, I'm a winner. Well, what did I win? I defeated something. What did I defeat? You know, suddenly you're horizontal and you lost it. So just don't judge for the truth. Just feel the wow. That is the judgment for the truth. You've already made the one judgment that you only is needed. When you feel the wow, you've made the one judgment that you need. You only need one judgment, and that is that judgment isn't needed. So we are going vertical here in this video here. Amazing, right? And it was wow. We're going vertical. We're wow. Yeah. There isn't a how to it, there's a wow to it. Okay? There isn't a how to it, there's a wow to it. When you go how, you're going horizontal. When you go wow, you're going vertical. See, truth is already true. So all we have to do is accept this. And when we start accepting it, we feel wow. I'm accepting it. I made the only judgment I need to make, that all I need to do is accept it. Wow. It's really happiness creeping into us, as it were. But this happiness that's creeping into us is not the happiness of the horizontal, like saying, oh, I'm making things fair now, that makes me happy, or I'm sort of relieved, or I think I'm going towards happiness. I mean, the happiness of the horizontal is always, I think I'm going towards happiness, like that sort of thing. Whereas when the wow is like, no, wow, happiness is what I am. I don't need to do anything to be happy. Wow. You see, this is the wow. I don't need to do anything to be happy. Nothing at all. I don't need to think any thoughts to be happy. I don't need to do anything to be happy. I don't need to make any judgments at all to be happy. And this is the final judgment. I don't need to make any judgments in order to be happy. I am happy. I am is happy. So this, the wow is, this is creeping into us. This is, you know, intrinsic happiness, which is called bliss. Intrinsic happiness is differentiated from I think I'm going to be happy. It's intrinsic happiness is called bliss. There's no effort, no judgment in order for this to the bliss to be there. So the wow is us creeping closer, you know, to acceptance. And so we don't try to rush it. We be very careful to not try to rush it. That'll backfire on us, and then we'll go horizontal. So that's why I say, just whatever wow arises, then that's how much you're ready for, and just let it be. Don't try to judge for it, because then you're going to try to rush it. And when you try to judge for it, you're automatically thinking you can judge against it. And what we're really saying is you can't really judge against it. It's not possible. We can delay, but delay is not really a judgment. You know, it's a fear. It's a continuity fear. But if we say, yeah, okay, I need to judge for this, then you automatically say, I need to judge against something else. And then the bliss is gone. See, the bliss knows that no judgment at all is necessary. This is intrinsic what it is. It doesn't require us judging for it to be what it is. So the less we judge for it, the more it creeps into us, the more we're going vertical, the more wow there is. Now, I mean, I'm hoping for a bigger wow, yeah, and sometimes it comes on strong, other times not so strong. You'll have these ebbs and flows. There will be, you know, and just be, don't try to rush it. The whole key is, by not rushing it, you're allowing it to be what it is. So as I say, slow down in order to go faster. Slow down in order to speed up. We keep thinking that we can speed it up by judging, and that actually slows us way down. Go horizontal then. Bliss is not the result of any judgment. It's not like we made a right judgment and then therefore we're blissful. So the final judgment is that we don't need any judgment. It's not that we made a right judgment, it's that we realize we don't need any judgment. Okay, this is what's crucial. So when you're hearing this, you're hearing, you know, the right teaching. You're hearing right teaching. I'm hearing it as I say this. I'm hearing it because I have a willingness to extend the teachings of Jesus, to extend the teachings of truth. So because I'm willing to do this, I'm able to say this. But it certainly affects me very strongly. Very strong. Wow. I'd say, hey, it is possible to go vertical. We're doing it. But if we try to do anything other than this, then we've gone horizontal. And the misery that brings, just the hope. I'm afraid of it, you know. I say, I'm going to lose this, you know, and go back horizontal. It's like, oh my gosh. So this is the agony, you know, of the path. There's some agony in it. Because you can feel that this is right. I've gone vertical. And if I go horizontal, I'm going to be lost in confusion again. And say, oh my God. Because we have a continuity fear with true happiness, bliss. Because we think we've been thinking for quite a while, reinforcing, tremendous reinforcement that happiness comes from thinking that we're going to be happy. That without thinking that we're going to be happy, we'll never be happy. This is, of course, judgment, an attempt to believe in the two wills and judging and have one, the one that we've imagined to become greater. So we've reinforced so much that thinking we're going to be happy is the only way to happiness. So we've been thinking that there's a way to happiness, and which was horizontal, right? There's a path to happiness. What we're saying is there's no path to happiness. Go vertical to say there's no path to happiness. And then just like, wow, I heard this, wow. Now, I certainly apologize to any teachers that have been in the world, how stupid I've been, you know? I mean, but I have to say that whoever you are, you have helped out. You have helped, obviously, you know? It's just that it's quite a struggle to accept this, you know? So I feel there might have been some teachers in the world, you know, and I just, for some reason, had troubles, but somehow it seeped into me, you know? I mean, it doesn't, just because you're a teacher and there's some don't come to you for help, you know, doesn't mean you're not helping them. Maybe they've read something and they you know, it starts seeping into them. So it has seeped into me. So I thank everyone here who's witness to the truth, to the verticality of truth, everyone. You know, somehow, whatever you've done has helped out. It has seeped into me. And also, I do realize that the one we call Jesus is a perfect teacher. Is a perfect teacher. So there's nothing wrong with listening to a perfect teacher. Nothing wrong at all with that, you see. So there have been, it seems as though there's some teachers in the world have been historically who have, you know, or who are now, you know, reinforcing what Jesus is saying, reinforcing what the perfect teacher is saying. Now, not all teachers are perfect. Some of them are still students. They're trying to be perfect, but they can be very helpful. And some of them are actually quite, quite quite good, and some of them may have even reached equality with perfection, perfect teacher. But, you know, we don't need to struggle with it. We just say thanks. Thanks be to all the teachers of truth. Thanks be to all the teachers of truth. Very helpful. That doesn't mean it hasn't been difficult. It's been extraordinarily difficult. So it's ultimately we need to just remain vertical here. Now it seems difficult to do, because we get caught up in commenting on the horizontal, you know, about what's going on, and because we were used to thinking about becoming happy, thinking there's a way to happiness, so that our happiness is predicated on thinking there's a way to happiness. And so then that pulls us horizontal, right? Yeah. We hear this over and over and over again, and it sinks in gradually. So you may hear this and go vertical for a little while, and then you go back to being horizontal. Well, join the club. I mean, this is what we all struggle with. This exact same struggle for everyone is we keep going back from the vertical to the horizontal. You know, there isn't anything other than that happening. So we're all having the exact same struggle. However, we attach concepts and labels to it. You know, it's the same struggle. Exact same struggle. And people say, well, my struggle is unique. Well, the way we label it is unique, but the struggle is exactly the same. And this may be why the teachers of God get pulled off the vertical, you know, and because everyone comes to them and say, well, my problem is unique. Well, no, the way you label it is unique, but the struggle is exactly the same. You're struggling to stay vertical. But you're struggling to say that I don't need any judgment. The final judgment is that there is no judgment to make. I don't need to make any judgment to be happy. We're all struggling to stay in that, which staying in that is bliss. So we're all struggling because for bliss. We want bliss. And we keep going back to say, I think I need to think of a way to be happy. I'm thinking about becoming happy. I'm thinking about being happy. And then automatically, we think we need to do something. That there's something has to happen. That's horizontal. So, same struggle for everyone. Unique labeling for everyone. So, each one of us will talk about our struggle in a certain way, as if somehow our struggle is unique, because we need to express the uniqueness of our struggle. But ultimately, what we need to realize is our struggle is not unique at all. And this is the wow, isn't it? This is the wow. Our struggle is not, there is no unique struggle. The struggle is just to stay vertical, that's all. And the answer is to make the final judgment, accept the final judgment that there is nothing to judge. There's nothing to judge. The final choice is nothing to choose between, actually. And that happiness is intrinsic. It's not anything that I reach or become or find at all. To believe that I reach, find, discover, become is horizontal. That means there's a struggle between two wills. You know, there is no struggle. There is no two wills. There's no struggle at all. So I don't need to make any choice at all. See? And accepting that there's no choice at all to be made. It's not that there's a choice, but I'm not making it. No. It's that there isn't any choice. So, you know, if we think there's a choice to make, but I'm not making it, and that this is bliss, then we're into what called trance states, meditative trance states. And of course, as Buddha told us, that's not the way, right? Buddha's another perfect teacher. Okay. People with various labels might want to you know, listen to Buddha. They've labeled their uniqueness in that way. Okay. But trance states, Buddha went through all these trance states and said, wow, that's not it. Because what that really is saying is that there is a choice, but I'm choosing not to make it. And that's why I'm feeling, you know, quote unquote, blissful. But not really only having a concept of bliss. You're thinking of bliss, thinking that there's no choice, but that's still believing that there's a choice, but I'm just not making it. And then Buddha said, well, let's get rid of the chooser. Let's try that path, mortification of the flesh. You say, okay, there is a choice, but there's no chooser. Okay, so Buddha tried that way. That didn't work either. And then Buddha said, wait a minute, it's neither. There isn't any choice. So it's not like I need to avoid the choice in a trance state or get rid of the chooser. Neither one of those. There isn't any choice. So there you go. If, you know, those of you who feel that you have some uniqueness and you need to express it as a Buddhist, fine, that's fine, however you want to. But for me, you know, there's no question that Jesus is a perfect teacher. There's no better teacher. And has expressed it, you know, beautifully and clearly. So I'm a student of Jesus, but I also give great homage to all perfect teachers and all students of those perfect teachers. Because they're saying the exact same thing. Just stay vertical. There is no choice. So it's not like you need to just refuse to make the choice and you'll be happy. And it's not like you need to insist that there is no chooser. It's that you need to say there isn't any choice. Okay? So we go from duality to non-duality. Duality is to say there's a choice, but I'm not making that choice. That's called being in nirvana. And then that's duality. And then to say, well, there is a choice, but there's no chooser, is to go into austerity. Okay? That's not the answer either. So we say there is no choice at all. This is non-dual. This is what Jesus is teaching us in a very, very effective and wonderful way. So there are those who, you know, have different traditions, and the reason why I'm highlighting Jesus is because Jesus has come back to the world. So he deserves it. He deserves to highlighting it. And I'm a student of Jesus. I'm a student of Jesus. You know, so, but I'm certainly calling upon everyone from whatever tradition is to go vertical. So don't get caught up in the uniqueness of your labels at all. Don't get caught up in it. And you say, well, why are we labeling it Jesus? Well, if we're going to talk about it at all, you know, you're going to use labels. And the fact of the matter is Jesus has returned as he promised. And he has brought this superlative teaching with him. And so give homage to the practicality of the situation, okay? Don't outsmart yourself. Don't outsmart yourself. It's the wise give homage to the practicality of the situation. Okay, and the fact is Jesus has returned to this world. He is here. He is putting his full attention on the world right now. So, but in no way is he trying to say that the labeling Jesus, you know, is somehow a superior labeling to the labeling Buddha or labeling whatever, right? Krishna, you know, whatever. He's saying there is no uniqueness to there is no really uniqueness at all to the struggle. There isn't any. So all homage to the one who clarifies this so beautifully and is here now, okay? What happens is people get caught up in going horizontal and arguing about the uniqueness of labels, which is, you know, that is refusal to go vertical, refusal to go wow. So all Jesus is telling us is to go wow. He's not pointing us to a person Jesus or a label Jesus or anything like that. He's pointing us to the bliss, the uncaused bliss, the inherent bliss that doesn't, not based on judgment or thinking at all. And just abide in that bliss. Now, we're going to use some label. Some people say we're Mana Maharshi. We can use that label. So, if we're going to use some label, be practical about it, is what I'm saying. And Jesus is the one who is putting the big push on right now, here in this world. So, all homage to that. All homage to that. And all homage to the practicality of that. But certainly people insist upon being tripped up on labels, you know, which is, we have, the label we're really using here is wow, okay? The label we're really using here is wow. And the one that is truly encouraging us to use that label, wow, is Jesus, is what we refer to as Jesus, the one that has been here before and has come back. So the one who has been here before and comes back, you know, and gives us a tremendous teaching. And has students who are proficient in that teaching, you know, be pragmatic about it. But we can go beyond, well, let's put it this way. There are those who are used to using the labels. And we're not asking you to change horses in midstream. So those are used to using the label Jesus for the wow, for bliss. Why should they have to shuffle? That's going horizontal. That's trying to be fair. See, immediately you're into horizontalness. And the ones who have gone, who have been Buddhist, why should they have to change labels too? So it seems as though there are those then who are able to teach in various traditions to help those who are used to those labels to say, hey, it doesn't matter. You don't have to change your labels. Just go, wow. Just decide, make a decision. I don't need to make any judgment. This is wow. And this transcends labels. So really, this teaching I'm giving is a sort of an ecumenical transcendent teaching. Now, I don't know, but I'm not sure if there is this transcendent teaching, or I'm trying to reach those who have, you know, are used to labels using Jesus, using the label Jesus. This is still a question that I have, I'm not sure. But certainly, the bliss has nothing to do with any uniqueness of labels at all. And we have to go beyond any uniqueness of labels at all. The Buddhist needs to go beyond the Buddha. The Christian needs to go beyond Jesus. Needs to go beyond Christ. You know, the Hindus need to go beyond Shiva, Vishnu, and what's the other one? my mind is not geared right now for that. The Trimurti, you know. The Creator, the Preserver, the Destroyer. Brahman. Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva, something like that. I don't know. Apologies to the Hindus. My mind is not engaged with that gear at this second. But if I could shift over there, it would be like that. But because we're trying to go beyond labels here to the wow, so I'm introducing just this wow practice, and Now, I have said before that to balance the horizontal out can be helpful to go to the vertical. So, a lot of people are hung up on the labeling, the uniqueness of the labeling. And they think without that uniqueness of the labeling, somehow, you know, that they won't be happy. So, you know, I'm just speculating. It could be that the Buddhists need to balance out with Jesus, you know, and the Hindus, the Buddhists and the Hindus need, I don't speak too much of Islam because they don't want other people speaking of Islam, so to speak. So that's why. But so I use it as terms like the Buddhists and Hindus, which don't seem to be so adamant about nobody saying anything about them except themselves. But the wise ones will understand. You got to go beyond the belief in the uniqueness of labels. Because in bliss, there is no uniqueness of labels. It's just bliss. There's no judgment. There's no way to get there. There's no path to get there. It's realized I don't need any path to be where I already am. And so the uniqueness of labels falls away. So if you're stuck in a certain religion and the uniqueness of the labels of that religion, it can be very helpful to focus on another religion to say, hey, wait a minute, maybe I'm not so unique. So it's just like in the politics, you know, what I did was I balanced it out. I said, wait a minute, you know, I'm liberal, but now I'm going to be conservative, and now I'm going to be independent. And by balancing the two, like for instance, the liberals and the conservatives, by being familiar with both, then you realize, hey, wait a minute, it's not either one. It's not, there isn't some uniqueness of labels, and then you're able to get past it. So like Christians can be helped actually by listening to Buddhism, for instance. And Buddhists can be helped by listening to Christians, for instance. Because the real goal is to go beyond the uniqueness of labels. You believe that your struggle is unique. It's not. It's not unique to anyone. Ultimately, this has to be realized. And the idea, well, we need to make one world religion where there's, no, this is faulty. What we're really getting is this dominance of the feminine, the mother, saying that we have this other will that's now dominating. You see? Because when you balance it out, you're in bliss. There isn't a question of we need to make a world religion or anything like that. You're finished. Bliss doesn't have a religion, actually. So Longchenpa came to me to help me out with Buddhism. I understand, gave me a, you know, crash course in Buddhism. Now, and Ramana Maharshi, Nanda Mahima helped me with Hinduism. So I'm very well acquainted with those. But my mind is also now balancing out those, helping balance those out by also introducing Jesus and Christianity, because the Buddhists and the Hindus don't really understand Jesus. They think that their teaching is unique and that their salvation is unique and superior or something like that, right? It's not. It's not. Jesus is saying the exact same thing as Buddha. Buddha is saying the exact same thing as Jesus. Exact same thing as Ramana Maharshi, you know, etc. So we have to get past the uniqueness of labels. A lot of Christians are fanatics about the uniqueness of labels, right? There's no question about it. This is a problem. Islam is very fanatical about the uniqueness of their labels. Very fanatical about it. Whereas some of the older religions are not so fanatic. Buddhism is not quite, you know, not so fanatic, and Hinduism is not so fanatic. And Christianity is not so fanatic at this time. There's a little bit of wiggle room there, you know, to say, hey, wait a minute. maybe we need to get past the horizontal. Maybe we need to go vertical here. And not all Islam is fanatic, but we're just seeing the face of it, unfortunately, is the fanaticism we're seeing, but certainly not all Islam is fanatical as what we're seeing with now in this world, with the fanatics. You know, they're very fanatical. Well, let's keep in mind that Christians, Hindus, Buddhists also can display that face. There are some fanatical faces too. For instance, Tibetan Buddhism right now, there are some, right? Absolutely. Insisting on the uniqueness of their labels. Let me keep in mind Longchenpa, the great Buddhist teacher. I haven't had the slightest problem with him whatsoever. He's not a fanatical Buddhist at all. He's completely beyond Buddhism, actually. Just as Jesus is completely beyond Christianity, Longchenpa is completely beyond Buddhism, actually. I mean, a lot of Christians say, you know, listen to Jesus in A Course in Miracles is a way of helping us get beyond labels. And they say, wait a minute, where are the labels? You know, you're not Jesus, you're fake. Okay, I don't see the labels there that I'm used to. Again, getting past this belief that somehow our struggle is unique is all important. It's not unique. It's exactly the same for everyone. And seeing this is going vertical. So again, I say to all the Buddhists, Longchenpa is not a fanatical Buddhist at all. In fact, he's not even a Buddhist. He's beyond Buddhism. Buddhism. Absolutely beyond it. But Buddhism does include this very important facet of saying, if you see the Buddha, it's not the Buddha. You know, I mean, good. You know, if you're on the path, you see the Buddha, kill the Buddha. You know, you're supposed to go beyond Buddhism. You know, they try to emphasize that. You know, so Longchenpa certainly is not a Buddhist, really. But he can certainly talk about it and explain it, and he's, you know, an expert on, you know, Buddhism, he's an expert on it, but he's not a Buddhist. He's beyond a Buddhist. He's beyond Buddha, so to speak. The Buddha that said this Buddha is not the Buddha, right? Yeah. But at the same hand, because we are so stuck on labels, to just insist that everyone dispense with all labels altogether is ridiculous, because that's like saying, well, we're all vertical already, so we don't even need to make any effort. No, we need to make the effort to see. We don't need to make any effort. You know, some people try to outsmart themselves this way. You cannot do this. There is this enormous difficulty we have. There's this enormous temptation to go horizontal. So we must engage with this, continually bring ourselves to vertical. But in the engagement, we do need labels. You cannot just say, well, let's just all dispense with all labels. This is a mistake that some have made. Some of the people who say they're non-dual teachers may have made this mistake. They say, well, there's nobody to choose. They do the nobody to choose fallacy that Buddha pointed out as a fallacy. Or, you know, they go the nirvanic fallacy. Well, there's a choice, but I'm just not making it. I'm beyond making choices. There is a choice, but I'm beyond making choices. That's a nirvanic fallacy. And then they say, well, that there's no one to choose, so that's it. That's the, you know, the non-dual fallacy. Let's just use no labels at all. That's ridiculous. Let's just not make a choice. No, there isn't any choice to make. So we can't say, well, let's just not make a choice. We need to say, I can see there is no choice. It's different. I'm seeing there is no choice. No, I'm not saying, well, there just is no chooser. So, you know, that's not the right way to go about it. So, of course, we are stuck in the uniqueness of our labels. We have to be helped from where we're at. We are terribly stuck in the uniqueness of our labels. And it is possible to become terribly stuck in the non-uniqueness of our labels. It's possible to get stuck there instead of go to be in bliss, instead of bliss. So for those who are stuck in some way, what I say is balancing it out is very, very helpful. If you're stuck in Buddhism, which many do get stuck in Buddhism, they're stuck in one way or the other, nirvanic or austerity or simply there is no chooser, or stuck in I'm so uniquely aware of the non-uniqueness of labels. You know, they get stuck in that. I'm uniquely aware of the non-uniqueness of labels. Well, I would suggest paying attention to Jesus and Christianity, or Jesus, you know, pay attention to it. It may be fabulously helpful, just like me paying attention to Buddhism was very helpful, actually. Paying attention to Longchenpa helped me out greatly. And then what happened? I turned back to Jesus even more clearly. Longchenpa didn't try to take over and say, hey, you need to listen to me and not Jesus. No, he said, here, I'm going to help you. I'm going to give you a boost. But, you know, go ahead. You know, of course, stay with Jesus. That's your teacher. That's your primary teacher. Stay with it. But I'll help you balance it out so you're able to get past even claiming that I have a unique understanding of the non-uniqueness of labels. Okay, this is a trap that some are trapped in this. The non-uniqueness of labels, meaning you realize that there isn't any choice at all, and then the wow is just a wow. It's not saying, hey, I have a really unique take on the non-uniqueness of labels. No, it's just the wow. You have to go into the wow and then into the bliss. And the only way we get in, accept the bliss is to keep practicing this wow, because this wow is just the recognition of bliss, really. Uncaused happiness, right? The only happiness there is. There isn't any choice. It's not there's a choice, and I'm not making. I'm above making choices. That's one of the great mistakes, and it's not saying that. There's a choice, but there just isn't a chooser. That's the other great mistake, is to say that there is no choice at all. So those who can remain in this awareness are genuine non-dual teachers. Genuine non-dual teachers, which is what we're striving for here, is what I'm striving for, of course. I can see it, but to stay in it is... One has to stay in it to be a genuine non-dual teacher. You know, when Buddha, for example, now you may be many Christians listening to this, and they might be saying, "Ah, why are you talking about Buddha?" Keep in mind, you need to balance out the belief in the uniqueness of your struggle, of your labels, right? Otherwise, you're going to be stuck. So, when Buddha. First, he tried the trance states of nirvana, saying, I'm above choosing. There's a choice, but I'm above that. And then he said, that didn't work. So he said, well, I'm going to say, well, there is a choice, but there is no chooser. I'm going to mortify the body. There's no chooser. That didn't work. So then he abandoned both those, and then he was enlightened. Okay? And so he's walking about, and he's just this middle-aged man that people look at him, and the ones who he used to practice with, the ones he used to practice trance states with, the ones he used to practice austerities with, they looked at him and laughed at him and mocked him. He says, look at you. You're sold out. You're just some middle-aged man who is just, you know, you're not even a spiritual aspirant, a renunciate anymore. You know, you're eating food, you're sleeping, you're going about, you gained weight, You know, you're not meditating, you're not in trance states, you're not austerities, you know, you're not doing anything. You're not even on the spiritual path. You know, what a loser. What a loser. And Buddha said, no, let me explain to you what happened. You know, and then some listened to him. And they said, wow. And they started to realize, oh my gosh, you know. I think I've been, you know, I've been caught up in this delusion, you know, like starting to see their self-delusion. Yeah, so they say, you're the Buddha. Yeah, and he said, well, yeah, okay, I'm not going to take all labels away from you, but I'm really not the Buddha. I'm neither the Buddha nor not the Buddha. You cannot attach a label at all to. You cannot label I am this or I am not this. I am uncaused bliss. See, no judgment is required. No choice is required. So as soon as you say that there's a chooser, you're the Buddha. You said, well, you made a choice. No, I did not make a choice. I saw that there is no choice to make. But he did not take labels away. Just so Jesus does not take labels away from Christians, say, you know, you got to take the label Jesus away. No, because that puts the cart in front of the horse. There isn't anyone who did or did not make a choice. The truth is, there isn't any choice to make. There isn't any choice there. So there's no one say, well, I made the right choice. You know, I'm Jesus. I'm a Christ. I made the right choice. No, there isn't any choice to make. I'm Christ because that's the will of God. I'm Buddha because that's the will of God. I'm Buddha mind. That's the will of God. There's no way around it. It's basically saying there's no way around the will of God. So I am free. Why does freedom need labels? It doesn't. There's no labels that can define freedom at all. So ultimately, you know, our freedom is entirely, you know, beyond labels, label free. There's no call. It cannot be defined at all. We cannot define what we are at all. So what do we say to this? Wow. So the label that I find is most helpful is wow. But we're not dispensing with labels altogether here. The Buddhist can say wow, the Christian can say wow, you know, the Hindu can say wow, anyone can say wow. Like, wow, Jesus, wow, Buddha, wow. Brahma, wow. Rama, Vishnu, Shiva, wow, the creator, wow, the preserver, wow, the destroyer, wow, just wow. Go back to wow, because wow is again glimpsing the bliss of freedom. It's like, wow, I can't be defined. So labels are ultimately meaningless, aren't they? So there is no real struggle with labels at all, really. There is no uniqueness. So, Christians are extremely stuck in labels, extraordinarily stuck in labels. I've tried to help them out. I'm trying to help them out. So Jesus is trying to help them out. There's no question about it. Of course, in miracles helps out a lot with that. Many Christians are upset with it because they say, where are the labels? What do you mean? You're messing with our labels. It's not... messing with the labels. I mean, the labels are still honored. Absolutely. We can, there's no reason to attack labels. We understand that we've been struggling to get back to vertical. And so the labels that we're using is what we've been trying to use to help us get back to vertical. So we're certainly not against that. And also, we certainly realize that in order to stay vertical, we have to realize the non-uniqueness of all labels in order to stay vertical. So the problem with it, with religions, and for example, Christianity, is just, since I'm speaking from this standpoint, from basic, my pragmatic circumstances, okay? Is that, they use these labels to try and get to vertical, but then we try to stay vertical by clinging to these labels, which then throws us back into the horizontal. You know, you get a glimpse and then you try to throw labels on it instead of just wow. So what I say is use the labels, Jesus, whatever, you use those as a framework to approach the vertical. But when you get a glimpse of truth, then use the wow. Okay, then use the wow, because this wow does not pull you back into any tradition of labels, okay? Even if the tradition is the non-uniqueness of labels, it doesn't throw you into that tradition either. So, wow, yeah, this is a big wow. This teaching is very profound. I'm stunned by it, really. It's very vertical. See, the vertical is grounded in truth already. Truth is already true. The vertical is just the acknowledgement, acceptance of it. Just is realization. I don't have any choice, but truth is already true, and I don't have any say in it whatsoever. I don't have any say in it. Now, some people are stuck. When you're stuck in the labels, you think, wow, I'm not getting to it. And you think, well, maybe some other tradition will help me get to it. A lot of Christians have abandoned Christianity and trying Buddhism, various other New Age teachings, etc. But really, you can use these other traditions to help balance out the unimportance of labels. And then that can help you get to the vertical. And then you just say the wow. But then you can go back to the labels you're comfortable with, but you just realize labels are not where it's at. Because what happens, you can trade one set of labels for another set of labels. That's often what happens. You might be a real fanatical Christian with the labels, and then you realize it's not getting you what you want. And then you suddenly become a New Age astrologer, whatever. You take all you become a mother worshiper or something. You take all the labels of that and say, oh no, these are the unique labels. That's what works, the uniqueness of these labels. So you're just changing one set of labels for another set of labels, and you still have belief in the uniqueness of labels. So you have to be very careful about that, which is why I say this practice of walking together in the wow is so helpful and so important. Is as long as you have this practicing of just know wow is the one label I'm going to use as that is most important. I'm just going to call it wow. Then you don't get stuck in exchanging one set of labels for another set of labels. So, I mean, Longchenpa has been helping me out a lot. Now, I'm not, I didn't go Buddhist, you see. Right? But what helped me was, is help freed me up from the idea of the uniqueness of labels. And so as a Christian, I don't feel like I have to go Buddhist. I don't need to go Buddhist. I can go vertical. I can go wow. See that? I can go wow. And when I used, go back to helping others, I can use the terms Jesus clearly, very clearly, without getting stuck in it, you know, in the uniqueness of labels. See, the whole idea of uniqueness is that there's a choice to make, and we have to be unique chooser. The reason we could say, well, the reason why I haven't been able to make the choice is I'm not a unique enough chooser. If I'm just a unique chooser, then I can make the choice. Okay, this is delusion. There isn't any choice to make. So how can we be a unique chooser? Now this is very, very profound teaching. I'm aware of it. You know, I've been lifetime of complete immersion in spiritual teaching, so I'm aware of what is a very profound and what isn't. This is very profound, so it's a shock. It's a wow. It's a big wow. So I just need to, you know, just recognize it. It's like, you mean the body can say these things? I mean, is that possible? Because we thought the body, you know, we need some unique, you know, chooser, the idea that we need to become a very unique chooser, and this is what works. And now I'm seeing, no, there isn't any choice. The whole idea of becoming a unique chooser, that's what we must drop. Very profound teaching. And the body's able to say this. And we say, well, so the body is not an obstacle. We thought it was an obstacle, right? We need to do austerity to some obstacle. I can't be a unique enough chooser unless I, you know, no, there isn't any choice. So how can I be a very unique chooser? So the body can say this. The body is just a communication device, like a microphone. You speak through the microphone, it picks up whatever you say, or whatever you're singing, whatever sound you're making. It's not choosing the microphone and saying, well, you know, you can't say this, can't say that. No, the body is just this mechanical speaking device, communication device. But it's like, wow, you mean the body can say that? I mean, I didn't know that. I can communicate that, use the body to communicate this. Wow. So I'm pretty shocked right now. My mind is fairly shocked. Which is good. I'm under so much pressure right now. Which is good. You know, I can resent it, you know, I get resentful of it. Sometimes I do. But still, it's still good. I have to, you know, it really forces, you know, pushes me to take a look at this and realize I can communicate it. It's one thing to look at it. There are those who can look at it, but to communicate it is a different story. Because again, there are those who say, no, I got to be in the nirvanic state, and they can't communicate it then. Or I need to be in the austerity state, and they can't really communicate it. But to be in neither of those, I realize there isn't any choice at all. And then to communicate that, you know, that's where the real intensity, the truth is. That's the true communication of truth, which has always been my aim. That has been my aim from day one. In coming this lifetime, that's been my aim. You know, and some of the old habits that I had from previous lifetimes grabbed a hold of me, as you would expect. That's the challenge, is don't let the habits of previous lives pull you down in this life. And the problem was, I was such a successful musician in the life previous to this one, a composer. And I was so successful that those habits grabbed a hold of me again. You know, I said, hey, wait a minute, maybe it'd be easier just to be a great musician again. That's easier, you know. I could be real famous, real successful, real rich, and get all sorts of adulation and fame, and I know how to do that. I've already done it, so I thought I could do that again. So that's pulled me down, and but yet I never gave up the effort to be, you know, to be a communicator of the truth. I said, no, I got to do this. This is my goal. So this has been my goal, but other stuff kept trying to distract me away from it. You know, music, especially. And what everything that goes with music, which is a lot, you know, you get all the, you know, adulation of those who just think that music is the answer, you know, fanatics. I don't think there's any fanatics worse than musical fanatics. They talk about religious fanatics being dangerous. Well, what about musical fanatics? They think that the labeling, which is music, that's the answer, that uniqueness. Oh yeah, this one is uniquely great, and this is the answer, and they must continue to be that, you know, and in order for me to be happy. And how, you know, you become imprisoned by the fans, by the fanatics, actually. Okay, I mean, you look at, like, comments on YouTube on songs and everything, and it's easy to see the fanaticism. There's no fanaticism greater than, yeah, who's the greatest guitar player? Well, it's this one. You know, their uniqueness of their expression, that is the greatest one, right? And they are just so fanatic about it. And they will spend a lifetime arguing about this, you know. And I know what that's like. I used to be there. I absolutely was a music fanatic. I've been there, done that. I fostered a lot of music fanaticism. So I understand that, and it's terrible, actually. It's horrible. It's an immense, extreme, you know, block to realization, to bliss, actually. You know, who's the best? Oh my God, you want arguments? Oh God. Because each one has their favorite group, their favorite song, or also those who try to play high and mighty and say, no, I'm unique in that I'm ecumenically unique and that I like all the different songs, and that's it, you know. That's not it either. That's hubris, that's pride, that's delusion too. Very strong delusion, you know. There's some, like I say, who are very trapped in that too, of course. Afraid of bliss, continuity fear. So the wow is drop the judgment, practice dropping the judgment bit by bit, and you say, oh my gosh, but if I do this, I'm going to feel like perfect. You know, ah. I'm not used to that. I'm used to thinking about feeling perfect. You know, meaning time. I'm used to thinking that it's something to be accomplished. You mean I can feel perfect right now, feeling perfect now? I mean, continuing to feel perfect. I keep thinking it needs to be substantive, you know, some process, some time, space, process, and form. But no. So this is what we have to get to. We have to get to this. And so I'm able to help, you know, help us get to that. Help myself, help others get to that. I'm certainly very cognizant of the music trap, having experience that to the utmost. It's more dangerous than the religious trap in a lot of ways, because it feels superior, you know, to the religious trap. Those who are in that think, oh, we're superior, so how can we be trapped? They don't see that they're just as trapped. It's the same trap. They say, no, this is superior. It's a superior trap. Saying that the superior trap is the same trap. It is all the same trap. But let's be honest, fanaticism of any kind can be, you know, it's very severely trapped. I mean, religious fanatics, that's a severe trap as well. As well as religious, severe non-fanatics can be a severe trap as well. Yeah, I'm a uniquely great non-fanatic, you know. That's still not seeing that there is no choice. And they say, I don't need to practice. I'm unique. That's believing that there's a choice. I'm a unique non-chooser. Why? They're saying you can choose to be either unique or not unique. There isn't any such choice. There isn't any such choice. This is what we're getting to. So the wow has to be practice. It has to be practice. This feeling of just, oh my gosh. This is fantastic. I mean, I'm not stuck. Oh my gosh, there isn't any choice. How can I be stuck? There's no choice. I'm not stuck in nirvana nor samsara. Nirvana is saying, well, there's a choice, but I'm not making any choice. Samsara is saying that there's a choice, but there's no chooser. So, oh, this is just happening to me. There's no cheer, just happening to me. And I can, you know, that's the ultimate. That should be happiness. And yet, I'm not happy. So I'm thinking that I'm going to be happy. I'm thinking I'm going to be happy. It's neither samsara nor nirvana, to put it in those terms. It's neither that there's a choice, but I'm not making a choice. I'm above making choices. I'm in nirvana, I'm superior, I'm above making choices. It's not that, and it's not, yeah, there's a choice that we made, but there's no chooser. So there's just no one making any choice. There's all these choices just happening to me. There's no one making the choice. It's neither one of those. The answer is that there isn't any choice at all. There's only one will. It's not some other will that we need to choose against. Say, no, I don't like you. I'm going to decide that I want you. There isn't any such choice like that. And this is what Jesus emphatically points out, beautifully, wonderfully, and emphatically points out. So, Jesus gave us a fresh canon, okay, of teaching. So, that's why I'm saying right now, for me, Jesus is more potent, very potent. The Course in Miracles is very potent. It's very contemporary. The freshness and potency is very strong, very contemporary, very effective. The other canons, the traditional religions of Buddhism, Christianity, Hinduism, etc. So much is accumulated, etc., etc. All right. Whereas this Jesus brought back this very fresh, extremely clear, strong, potent, fresh, focused, intense, you know, clarity. And so I saw that. I said, wow, this is really going to be more effective because it's so fresh and new, you know, and it has not accumulated all this baggage, etc., etc., right? All this, you know, fake uniqueness, etc. So pragmatically, I say, I'm going with this, absolutely. I'm going with what is going to be most effective and I know this is going to work. So, of course, just go with that. Be a fool not to. And, again, he's pointing out emphatically, there is no choice. There is no choice to make. And he doesn't mean that there's no choice that we have to put up with two wills. No, he's saying there is no choice, there's only one will. There's only one will, there's no choice. Therefore, there is no choice. Only truth and true and nothing else is true. Period. This is what he emphasizes again and again and again and again, many, 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 many ways. And people say, well, that's what Buddha said. Yes, true. But this canon of A Course in Miracles, for instance, is very fresh. And the potency of Jesus' help right now is very strong. He's back in this world. Now, is he back with the body? Well, it doesn't matter, because from the standpoint of Jesus, there is no body. So they're just appearances. So can Jesus appear as a body? Sure. Can he appear as a light body? Yes. Can he appear as not a body? Yes. I'm not saying that Jesus has been born as a body into the world again. I don't know. Maybe, maybe not. I presume not. You know, my presumption is no. He did not take another birth here. So he can certainly appear as a body, just an appearance, a form, as a form, as an appearance of a body. You know, sure. But I'm presuming that he certainly did not take an actual birth in a body. There's absolutely no need for him to do that, and you know, I don't think that would be very helpful for us, actually. But he's certainly back, bringing this tremendously fresh canon of teachings, and which is right emphasis, tremendous right emphasis right now. So it would be folly not to listen to those who are able to convey this, you know, and because this has got intensity behind it. Has intensity behind it. Now, do you really have to, you know, in bliss, do you have to label it? Well, not, you know, labels can be less and less and less, actually. But we don't fall into the sort of fake non-dual trap again of I'm uniquely beyond labels. Let's just throw them all away. You can see some of those teachers, there's no intensity there, right? They're just kind of sitting there like blah. Like they're paralyzed, kind of in a wheelchair. Yeah, I'm there's no labels. There's no chooser. There's no chooser here. I'm uniquely beyond labels. They you can feel the lack of intensity, of spiritual intensity with them. You know, what they're saying seems very good, but the lack of the spiritual attention and intensity and bliss is not there. And if you get it right and see and accept there is no choice at all, then you're going to be in bliss. And that bliss is going to grow, become more and more and more and more intense. And people are going to recognize that you're extremely blissful. So a lot of these non-dual teachers, they're not extremely blissful at all. They're just kind of blah, 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 blah. There's no chooser. So, you know, nothing else to say. There's no chooser. There's no one to choose. That's it. Okay. Blah. And there are others that are more relational, emotional, relational thing. But now, they can be in bliss and still relate to that way to some. That may be their way, the bhakti way of relational. That is possible, absolutely. And there may be some who seem somewhat dry. They'd be in bliss, but they're somewhat dry. That is also possible, yes, yes. But you will still feel the intensity of the bliss. You will feel there's something very fresh, an intense bliss, fresh. You know, you will feel, wow. You know, you absolutely will feel it if the teacher is legitimate and haven't got into one of these tricky side trips that, you know, that are just in a trance state, or there's no chooser, or an austerity state, you know, haven't got trapped by that. And then the authentic teacher, you will feel something that is just so fresh. Something astonishing, really. There's an astonishment there. You will feel this tremendous wow. It's beyond the relational thing, like, oh, let me give you a hug and love and light and blessings to you. You're such a wonderful person. I feel from the heart. I feel like I'm with you. It's something totally other than that, beyond that. I mean, not even beyond. It's just, it is way more profound than that. Way more astonishing than that. Incomparably, immeasurably more astonishing. We can't, as soon as we use labels, we're damning the situation with faint explanation, right? But it's just, there's something that is just way more wowish than, hey, here's a nice cuddly teacher, you know, way more wowish than that. Just something that's just wow. And the wow is the best way to express it I can come up with. Just something that is just really, really wow. Astonishingly wow. And you don't know what to say about it, which I say, just say wow. Don't try to label it. Just say wow. This is very helpful. Very, very helpful. Don't label it. You see, don't make the mistake of no label, because then we struggle. So just use one label, just say wow. It's a very fuzzy, abstract term, right? Just say wow. You have to, when you go to such a teacher, you're going to feel this, that which is beyond all definition, and then you're going to struggle to define it. And this is what causes you to, you go horizontal then. So the way to stay vertical is just to say wow. Wow, 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 and wow. And then just be in this intensity. Don't go horizontal. Just, if you use just this one term that has no horizontal associations with it, really, wow, then you're not going to be pulled horizontal. And then don't struggle with the wow. Don't struggle with the wow. Just be in the wow. Just be in the neutral mode. Don't label. But pragmatically, our mind insists on at least one label. You know, it will kind of say, well, what do I say? Can I say anything at all? Just say, wow. Okay, that's fine. Don't outthink yourself, because then you'll be struggling to not label it. You see? You don't want to get into that. I'm struggling not to label it. I'm struggling so hard not to label it. Now just say, okay, I'm just saying, all right, fine. Wow. Because remember, truth is not concerned about, there's no struggle in it. Doesn't need our judgment to be what it is. So it's not like we're going to go horizontal by saying wow. No, all we need to do is stay vertical. So if saying wow helps us stay vertical, wow. Now, experientially, pragmatically, I found this to be extraordinarily helpful. Someone who's gone through the whole rigmarole of all this difficulty that we have of how do we stay vertical. This is the task that I gave myself, the challenge I gave myself in this lifetime. Now keep in mind that the challenge I gave myself in a previous lifetime was to be, you know, a great composer, and I achieved it, I succeeded. So I'm used to taking on a big challenge and succeeding with it. So, I felt like I came in this world, I felt like I can succeed at this somehow. I'm going to succeed. I will not fail, I will succeed. Now, it's been extraordinarily difficult, to say the least. But it's not a surprise if I succeeded. It would not be so surprising at all. I expect to succeed, absolutely. And when people say, well, why don't you, you know, be this or this or this, I just brush it off like this. You know, that's I've been there, done that. You know, I've taken challenges on, so, and done that. So I'm not going to, you know, I want to succeed at this. This is what I want to succeed at. So I've taken on the challenge, and I am familiar with the difficulty. The rigmarole, the struggle, so I do know that this wow, just saying wow, is super helpful, super, super helpful, no question about it. It frees you from all other labels. It's the one label that frees you from all other labels, and that's the intermediate step that we need to take. Just like we exchange pretending to be dead for pretending to be eternal life. That's an intermediate step, because we're so used to pretending. To do away with pretending altogether is very difficult. So the bliss that we're experiencing is, you might say, is pretending to be blissful, pretending to be eternal life. But keep in mind that our capacity to pretend is unlimited in its creativity and scope. Okay, so we most certainly can do a fabulous job pretending to be blissful. The true teachers tell us that there is this bliss that we can experience in this world. And then there's the great bliss, which we really cannot experience for any length of time in this world. The body would just becomes inert when we do this. It ceases to communicate. Okay, so we're not aiming for the great bliss. We might have a few episodes of that possible, but I'm not trying for that at all. So I'm trying for the bliss, which really is pretending to be eternal life, if we want to be technical about it. So, we are allowed to use the label, wow, okay? We can use one label like, wow, it's okay, because it's still pretending. So there are some of those who try to, again, get stuck in the uniquely free of uniqueness kind of thing. And they say, well, we can't use any labels at all, you know, or something. No, that's ridiculous, because our goal is not the great bliss. Our goal is this intermediate step of bliss, which is ultimately, you could say, like a mirror. It's like holding up a mirror to bliss, the great bliss. It's a mirror. We're looking in the mirror, okay? And we can make a very, very, very nice mirror. But it's still a mirror. We're still looking at a reflected image of bliss, so to speak, which is fine. Because once we do that and are used to that, then it's easy for just no mirror at all. So there are many who have tried to outsmart themselves. There's no question about it. And they're very upset that it hasn't worked. And they think that if they just get you to believe that they've succeeded, that then that'll be happy. They'll be happy then. It doesn't work that way. So they demand of the teacher, some of this, a genuine teacher, they demand, you must recognize, my unique non-unique. My unique non-uniqueness, that I have uniquely dropped all labels. I'm uniquely label-free, And they don't understand there's an intermediate step. They're trying to make the leap, and it's not really possible. So many have tried to make that direct leap and get stuck. So to be a real teacher, helpful teacher here, you need to be aware of this, because this is a real problem. I saw you cannot make that leap. Pragmatically, we cannot make that leap directly. It's like saying we've reinforced the belief in pretending for so long that we think that's our functioning. We think our creativity has to be engaged in pretending. And for us to not pretend at all, we feel we'd be completely devoid of our functionality, that our creativity would have vanished. We think the two are synonymous, pretending and creativity. We think they're one and the same. So to leap directly back to the great bliss, we'd have to just let go of all pretending instantly. And for us, we think we'd be completely then without any creativity and functionality, which is essentially annihilation. So we don't do it. I've never seen an example of anyone that's done it. There are some who claim that they've done it, but they're actually stuck. Completely obvious to me. They're stuck. Just like I was stuck. I'm stuck. I tried to do it, couldn't do it. And then I saw it's not really pragmatically possible. I was very clearly aware of this. I said, uh-oh, I need a teaching that then points this out. And Jesus' teaching, A Course in Miracles, very clearly points this out and explains the intermediate step, which is why it's extraordinarily helpful for people of all different traditions and approaches who have tried to make this direct leap and then said, uh-oh, I failed. And then they try to fill in with a bunch of clever labels, and they become very facile with labeling, spiritual labeling, try to convince others that they succeeded because they're very scared. So they think, oh my gosh, I can't do it. So I'm stuck. So I have to, only my happiness has to come from convincing others how spiritually intelligent I am. You know, this is what happens. So I'm completely familiar with that and not judging at all. I mean, kudos to those who try to make the leap, you know. But they have to recognize, you know, that the intermediate step is necessary, it's required, really. And then become clear about what it is and say, oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, it is very audacious to try to make the direct leap. So all praise to those who try to do that, understanding, much respect. But that's as far as it goes, because now you're stuck, you know, stuck, and you need help. You need to, you know, you need to see. You need to be reassured. You need to be a student, you know. You need to be a student. Just like I tried to do it, failed. And then I said, I need help. And then I decided I have to be a student of Course in Miracles, student of Jesus, because that's what the Holy Spirit directed me to. And I was helped. See, I said, wow, I need help. It doesn't work. And I don't know what, then if this doesn't work, what does work? So again, we exchange our pretending to be dead to pretending to be eternal life. It's a way of labeling it. Of course, the one that thinks that they're beyond, have made the direct leap, but they know that in deep down they haven't, so they think they have to convince others that they have, they won't listen. They don't listen to teaching. They say, ah, I'm above that. I can use that spiritual talk too. I can do better than you with spiritual talk. But they're not listening to what the content is pointing to, the spiritual talk is pointing to. I'm not trying to pretend to be some great spiritual talker. I'm pointing to something very specific with the talk here. How to get free of being stuck. Like Buddha got free of being stuck. He said to those who were stuck in trance states and austerities, he said, hey, neither one of those is it. Okay? This is what's it. There is no choice. And Buddha was extremely helpful. That doesn't mean that Buddhists can't get stuck. Stuck, absolutely they do. In fact, most of them are stuck in one way. I mean, they do get stuck. As everybody gets stuck. So they need to get unstuck, of course. Who doesn't get stuck? You know, that's more of a question. Is there anybody that doesn't get stuck? No, I certainly got stuck. I've been working my whole life to get unstuck. 40 years, almost 40 years of intense effort to get unstuck. So the question is more, who isn't stuck? You know, only the rare, true non-dual teacher is not stuck. Example, Ramana Maharshi was not stuck. But he's not maybe the best example to use because he was like an avatar and came into this world fundamentally unstuck, and then just revealed himself at the right time, you know. So we're struggling to get unstuck. He didn't have that struggle. Nisargadatta Maharaj got unstuck, and he did have to work at it, you know. And Westerners tend to relate to Nisargadatta Maharaj a little bit more, because he seems to, you know, he got unstuck. Okay, and then he was maturing in that unstuckness, so to speak. There is some maturing in it. Whereas like Ramana Maharshi was like right on the edge of great bliss. You might say he was in perfect bliss. Perfect bliss, which is right on the edge of great bliss. You see, that's why he didn't do anything. He just sat there. Right on there. But that's more than we can do, really. It's an avatar, someone who's already, there's no struggle. You know, they're perfectly abide in bliss, perfectly. And they're right on the edge of great bliss. But for us, we just need to get to bliss. Okay, and then abide in that. So it may not be as difficult as we think, right? If we hold up these great teachers, I have to be like that. Well, we're not going to be like that right off the bat. let's first get unstuck. Let's first start, experience the bliss and work on staying in it. This is what I focused in. How do you stay in it is the question, right? That's what's important. And you don't get trapped in some intellectual spirituality saying, well, realizing that there is no staying in itness is staying in it. Again, we formed a clever spiritual conceptuality there. And then we're gone horizontal. It's like that. So I don't want to comment on other teachers really, because I'm struggling to be a teacher myself. I have to get unstuck myself here, and I don't feel qualified to really comment on other teachers, because you don't really know until you yourself are truly abiding in the vertical in bliss and staying in bliss. You don't really know for sure, okay? And that's a huge distraction. Because I don't really pay attention to other teachers. But again, pragmatically, I pay attention to Jesus. Because to try and say, well, I'm not paying to any teachers, then you're assuming this. I'm uniquely, uniquely not paying attention to teachers, which becomes a label, a clever spiritual label, you see. So I just don't get into comparativeness. I have one teacher, one primary teacher, Jesus Christ. I allow Longchenpa to help me because he has no spiritual ego whatsoever and is completely transparent. I'm not really aware of how he's helped me exactly. I know he gave me a great big boost, and so I'm not even worried about it. It's not even on my mind. I trust him. You might say utterly transparent, completely transparent. So Jesus is the one that I focus on as my teacher. Okay, plain and simple. I'm not comparing teachers. I'm not going to compare teachers. I'm not going to pay attention to other teachers. I know there are a number of popular teachers in the world. I don't pay attention to them. I really don't. Because I know if I just keep doing with what Jesus is telling me, I'm going to be a very effective teacher too. There's no question about it. Ramana Maharshi told me I would be. And there's another totally transparent teacher and didn't interfere with me. Just said, "Yeah, he said, stay with what you're doing." He says, "Don't listen to me. Stay with what you're doing. Okay, you're going to succeed with that." He knew. See, he was transcendent of Advaita Vedanta. He was transcendent of it. So he was not a fanatic Advaitin at all. Although the Advaitin said he was, he really wasn't at all. Not at all. He was just using the traditions and labels that people was helpful, but he was not fanatically attached to it whatsoever. I can testify to this in meeting Ramana Maharshi in spirit. Totally transparent. He says, stick with what you're doing. Don't try to change horses. Stay with it. You're going to be very effective. Just stay with it. So I say, oh, fine. So I allow, that to be there too, transparency. So, but my teacher is Jesus. I don't go to these other various, teachers that are contemporary now in the world who are popular. I don't pay attention to them. And I'm not going to make commentary on them. I'm not going to compare anything like that. My teacher is Jesus, plain and simple. I'm a student. I'm a student of Jesus, plain and simple. And Jesus is doing a fabulous job with me, doing a fabulous job. There's no reason to switch or compare. Why are you comparing if I got a teacher who's doing a fabulous job? Why do I waste time trying to compare and judge? No, forget it. No judgment anyway. I'm not trying to judge. Now, those that are stuck are extremely tricky. And, of course, everyone's stuck. So, everyone's extremely tricky. Because they're trying to figure out, You know, how do I convince others I'm not stuck even though I am? Because they think that's the only way to be happy, is to convince others that they're happy. This is the trouble, isn't it? And when we're in bliss, we say, wait a minute, I'm not convincing others I'm happy. How do I convince others? As soon as you do that, you're not in bliss anymore. The bliss, there isn't any choice except to be blissful. No one has any choice. You don't need to convince anyone of it. See, you don't need to judge for truth at all. This is what's, you know, this is what we need to hear. And you say, wow. I'm hearing the truth. Wow. See, when we can find the truth and hear it, but if we don't say wow, then we're going to judgment. We go horizontal, and we forget what was said, and we lose the momentum. So we just have to say wow to it. That's it. Don't, you know, just say wow. Just say wow. Wow. Hearing the truth. Wow. This is, you know, revolutionizing me. I'm hearing the truth. This is, I'll never be the same. This is revolutionizing me. And the wow just means, well, this is immeasurable. I mean, immeasurably revolutionized, you know. Really. My perspective is being immeasurably shifted, impacted. Just the impact is immeasurable upon my perspective here. That's, when you're doing that, you're acknowledging you're hearing the truth. And that's your final judgment. No judgment is required. The truth speaks for itself, so to speak, within me. This is just a reminder to look at. I'm looking at, oh my gosh, the truth speaks for itself. That's it. So, when you go to a teacher, refrain from asking about other teachers. That is, you know, that's not where it's at all. Because the truth speaks for itself. If the teacher is turning you to looking within and seeing the truth within you, then the wow is going to be there. That's all that counts. Don't get into comparing teachers or anything like that. Because then you're labeling. You've lost sight of the truth within you and in the wow. There's only a reaction of wow to it. You know, there's not labeling it. At all, really. So again, you know, don't talk shop with anyone you go to. Because when you're talking shop with someone you're going to, you're basically saying, I don't think you're a teacher. I don't think you can help me. So let's hang out together and I want you to recognize my unique not needing helpness, you know. And so then it's just on an ego trip. Just an ego trip. And it's half glass emptiness right there. So just be quiet and see if you can be inspired to glimpse the truth that is already present, that there is no choice to make. And it, when you glimpse that truth, you're going to feel the shock of recognition, and then just be quiet with that. So there's nothing much you need to say when you go see a teacher. If they're a teacher, they will, if you're willing and they're a teacher, then you'll be turned, you'll realize that truth speaks for itself. And then you'll feel the wow of this. So there's very little dialogue or anything you need to say, really. Sometimes there are teachers that are just silent most of the time. Like Ramana Maharshi, people just go see him. He's not going to say anything. Well, sometimes he talks, but very rarely. He's mostly just silent. So they realize he's not going to say anything, but he was able to turn them to listen to the voice of truth within them. You know, the truth speaks for itself, and they heard this, and they said, "Wow, And they're just silent. They went into silence. Wow. I don't need to label this. I don't want to struggle to label this. Let's just say wow and call it good. That's fine, because this is the intermediate step of bliss. Fine, it's a mirror to bliss, pretending to be eternal life, fine. That's good enough for now, for sure. That gives me all I can handle, beyond a doubt. And then you reach a point where you feel like, okay, I've done enough. And then you say, no, I'm going to stick this out. Like for me, I say, well, maybe I've said enough. No, I haven't. I'm clear enough. No, I'm. The bliss is still not here, which means I'm still on the edge of going horizontal. You know, too much on the edge of going horizontal. So I have to stick it out. I have to keep working at it. Now, I know the ones that watch the videos are, you know, very similar to me, you know, similarly realizing that they've been stuck and trying to see how to get unstuck. That's it. I mean, tend to be those who are very audacious, who had felt they were going to make an attempt to leap directly, you know, back into the great bliss. And then finding out that they can't do that, and then saying, oh my gosh, what do I do, you know? But, you know, conversely, those who do finally resolve this become, you know, really significant teachers, no question about it. That's what Ramana told me. He said, you're going to be a significant teacher, very effective, very, very effective. So that's what ultimately comes about when you tackle this challenge. Of you know, trying to leap directly back in reality and failing. You think, oh, I'm such a terrible failure, it's awful. No, because you end up then being very clear about, you know, how to get unstuck from all the different posturing that you tried to go into to try to say, oh, how can I be happy? I've got to convince others that I'm great or something. And eventually, you finally see the real way. You're driven to, you know, to see it, because trying to convince others that you're great in order to be happy is such a terrible strain. It's a horrible strain. Very frustrating. Everyone you see is your enemy, you know. Right? We see everyone as our enemy. They're not telling me how great I am. They're my enemy. They're the enemy of my happiness, essentially, is what we're saying. Of course, this is what I feel. I feel anyone who's stuck in this way, you know, feels that, you know, that other people are the enemy of my happiness. But you just need to recognize what's going on. It can seem as though, you know, that they're the enemies of your happiness, but ultimately they cannot stop us from bliss. They can't force us into choosing where there's no choice. They can't force. All we need to see is that there is no choice. It's not that we need to make the right choice. We need to see that there is no choice. Okay, this is the absolute crux of the entire situation. It's not that we need to make the right choice. It's that we need to see very clearly that there is no choice. Now, Jesus, again, the Course in Miracles says you need to choose once again, and you need to see the options. But what Jesus is really saying is we need to see clearly that the option that we think is there to choose is nothing at all. And so it's not really an option at all. That is only delay. Delay is not a choice. It's not really an option. It's just delay. It's not a true alternative at all. Okay, this is what Jesus points out to us. So ultimately, we need to see that there isn't any choice. There's nothing to choose between. But first, we have to clarify, what is it that we think we're choosing between? And see, it's only just this game of delay. It's not a legitimate option at all. It's just fake substantiveness, substantialness of time, space, process, and form. This is all a fake dream. It's a pretense. This is what we need, you know, to recognize this in some level. There's no choice. So it's not that we make the right, we have to learn to make the right choice. We have to recognize that there is no choice. Jesus says that's really, A Course in Miracles is not something you need to learn. It's not a course in learning, it's a course in unlearning. It's a course in unlearning. We've been learning to try to think that there's another option that we can choose, and we have to make the right choice. And Jesus says, no, we have to unlearn this to recognize there isn't any option to choose between. There are no options. There's the will of God is all there is. So there isn't any choice. So it's not that we make the right choice, as we realize there isn't any choice to make. And then you think, well, how can I be great? No one will think I'm great. I didn't do anything. Right. But you'll be a substantial teacher, for sure. Very substantial teacher. But certainly, your happiness isn't coming from others saying that you're great at all. And you won't be great in terms of, like, you know, a pop star or something where, you know, you get, you know, 100 million views on your music video sort of thing. And you're not great because you made the right choice. You see, this is what you have to realize. That we don't become great. We are intrinsically great. We're intrinsically perfect. So we don't become that way at all. So people will be saying, oh, you're so great, you're so great, you're great. And you realize that what they're saying is that you did something that you didn't do. So you might start feeling like, you might feel like a phony. You know, but that's a setup too, isn't it? They try to get you to accept that you're great based on their judgment of you, which then they're setting up you to then claim later that you're a phony. Yeah, it's very interesting dialectic there. Yeah, they say, oh, you're a great teacher, you had a great attainment, look at all these attainments, and then later on say, oh, you didn't really attain that at all, you know, I see through, you're a phony. That's a game that's being played, is a game, but now there's no attainment, no choice, no choosing. I didn't do anything, I didn't do anything at all. There's nothing that I need to do. And you might say, my God, this sounds like some profound non-dual teacher. Look, this is Jesus. I'm just, you know, saying what Jesus, I'm focusing on what Jesus has emphasized for me. And then people say, well, that's not Jesus. What are you talking about? Jesus is some guy nailed to a cross in a church or something. I say, no, that's our interpretation of Jesus, you know. That's a judgmental interpretation of Jesus. That's a dualistic interpretation. That's not Jesus at all. Jesus is this profound non-dual teacher. Absolutely. We just try to say, no, we want to use you to help us in our little game, a little play here. And this is the role we'll give you. So it's not that we make the right choice, we realize that there's no choice at all. Again, it's not that we make the right choice, it's that we realize there's no choice at all. And making the right choice means that we found some way to arrive. We finally arrived because we made the choice. No, there's no arrival at all. There's no choice to arrive at. We say, well, I finally arrived at the right choice. Well, how did you arrive at the right choice? Then the questions arise. And we say, no. I didn't arrive at the right choice because there isn't any right choice to make. There's no choice to make at all. So how can I have a path to arrive at the right choice? There isn't any. Well, then how'd you do it? Well, I just listened to, you know, a great non-dual teacher. And when I heard what was being said, I said, wow. Wow. That's true. Wow. Truth is true. Wow. Truth is true. That's it. You want to summarize A Course in Miracles? Just say a truth is true. And that's it. You can just say that. You don't even need to go any further. If you can accept this and accept the implications, the wowness of it, truth is true. And then, well, bliss. That's it. Truth is true. Bliss are actually perfect reflection of bliss. And then that's all we need to do while we're still quote-unquote here with bodies and such. The truth is true. Wow. Now, there are many who are trying to play both, trying to please both sides. Of course, that's what we do, right? And they say, well, maybe I'll be happy if I can succeed in that spiritual path. But what if I don't? Or, what if I don't? Then I better make sure that I'm going to be happy, find a way to be happy if I don't, you know, make it spiritually. And then they are trying to go along with what's happening in society and culture and trying to paper over, make it, you know, spiritual by papering over it. Little spider is still working. Still here. I got a little resident spider that just hangs out here and goes up and down this, you know, little rope. they're going along with this whole play we're doing, which is ultimately women to be completely dominant, the feminine to be completely the goddess, to be completely dominant, thinking that then we've got this imaginary other will as I finally now become greater than the will of God. And they're going along with that, but they're papering it over with spirituality. A whole bunch of, you know, they can talk the spiritual talk. They don't want to lose touch with that, but they're putting their eggs in two baskets. And it's called serving two different masters. Well, when you do that, certainly you're going to fail to realize that there is no choice. Well, Jesus says you can't serve two masters. You'll be disloyal to both. And then you're going to be really in this, like, wow, I'm just, what's wrong? You know, I can't really... I don't fit in anywhere, right? See, I don't fit in anywhere. Now, obviously, I'm not going along with, you know, the cultural thing. I've been very outspoken about it. But we do feel we're under enormous pressure, don't we, right now? So it's very important to be, quote-unquote, enlightened right now, which is, it's very important to abide in the vertical now. Abide in the wow, abide in bliss, abide in the vertical, don't go horizontal. Very important right now, because there's enormous pressure to go along with the play, you know, the play of I think I'm going to be happy as soon as this play has come to an end and this other will has finally triumphed. You know, that's what we're waiting for, the triumph, the victory of this other will. And I used to be a proponent. I used to be in that play. And I said, wow, okay, that's the only way to be happy. Okay, let's make sure this, let's hasten this along, you know. Let's worship the goddess. Let's get women and to be dominant. And then this will end the play, and then we'll be happy. And then I found out, uh-oh, that doesn't work. It's not going to work. Oh my gosh. It's all self-deception. We're not going to be happy. We're going to be absolutely miserable, actually. We're going to be suicidally miserable. For a while, it seems like full of hope. You start out full of hope, like, wow, this is we're finally going to be happy. And so you're motivated. For a while, you're very motivated. And you feel I'm being very accepting, very tolerant, very this. I'm being tolerant of this other will, so to speak, becoming dominant. And I need to tolerate that in order for the play then to come to an end. And then I'll be happy once this play comes to an end. But it may start out full of hope. But gradually you say, uh-oh, you start realizing the cracks. And say, oh my God, what's going on here? I'm just being used. I'm the one who's supposed to be now enslaved. I'm supposed to be helpless and hopeless. Uh-oh. I don't feel very good. You know, there's, I feel something's wrong. You know, and you start feeling like nervous about it and say, well, wait a minute. And, you know, and then you say, oh, but I'm not really going along with it. Uh-oh. If I don't go along with it, how can the play come to an end? And how can I be happy? And then you start getting kind of frantic and anxious. And you start looking for other opinions. So, wait a minute. Is there anybody speaking up on this who might give me some ideas? And then maybe you find a teacher that, you know, knows what they're really talking, you know, knows what it's all about. And you say, well, how can I please this teacher and then and also please the play, you know? So how do I do that? I've got to convince the teacher I'm really, really smart, you know? And I don't really need them. I need to get a diploma from the teacher. You know, and so they're more into, you know, how do I get that diploma? I got, but of course you can't. There's no diploma. Bliss is the diploma, and you only get that through recognizing that there is no choice. That you have no choice but to be blissful. Not by making a right choice. You don't get a diploma for making a right choice. So people go to, you know, diploma mill teachers. And they feel they got a diploma, and now they can, you know, go along with the play too, and that comes to an end, and you know they got it covered. You got it covered. Okay, how we doing? We're almost done here, actually. How is this possible? I don't know. It says it's only 2.5. 8 gigabytes. I don't know how to explain this. And we're almost at 2.5 hours, which is the cutoff point. Well, it's going to cut off anyway. I mean, even I put the limit at 4 gigabytes, and it says it's 2.27, but I believe it'll cut off anyway. I just, you know how software is. It just, these things are buggy. I mean, I cannot explain. It does what it wants to do. It's very capricious. What is that? What do I have? Oh, the spider was in my hair there. Hey, spider. Yeah, that's not allowed. It parachuted down onto my head. Okay. It probably is being, what in the heck am I doing here? You know, what do I have here? Maybe made enough headway. I don't know. I'm certainly shaking and trembling. You know, when you have a lot of wowness, you will shake and tremble. I mean, not perceptibly, really. You don't need to dramatize it. A lot of people dramatize all the reactions, try to show, look how much progress I've made. You know, don't dramatize it. You know, you should appear to the world to be just completely same as always, really. But there is a little. You know, inside I feel a little, you know, trembly and intensity. I mean, this has been very intense. And you see, I just dealt with the spider. I think, oh, there's a spider in my hair. Okay, let's get it out of my hair. And let's, oh, there it is. It's on my leg now. Okay, let's just get it off there. I didn't feel any fear, no reaction at all. Just a pragmatic situation I need to deal with. Okay. Keep in mind that I used to have an extreme arachnophobia problem, okay? Now, if you ask, can we succeed at something, a tough challenge? Well, there's just a little example, okay? First things, if there was a spider parachuting back up, down, and forth right before, I would never been here in the first place. The fact that I was able to focus in on this clearly with what used to cause me absolute panic shows you, you know, incredible, tremendous progress, amazing progress. And then when it actually landed on me, I said, oh, okay, well, I don't want to rock around my hair. Let me get off of here. And it's pragmatic, okay? Still focused, still completely focused. This is astonishment because I have, you know, as bad arachnophobia as you can have. I mean, I felt like I couldn't even be in the world because I was so scared of spiders. If I see a spider anywhere, I would just freak out. I'd be overcome with just extreme fear. anywhere. I just have to, you know, run away, get away. Oh my gosh, I'd be panicked. My whole reaction, just a panic reaction. I have a panic attack. Now there's not even a trace of it, not even a trace. But again, pragmatic. I mean, I don't want spiders. It's not like I want to embrace spiders. That's making a mistake. You know, trying to prove how great I am or something. That's a mistake. I still don't like spiders walking on my head. I mean, who would? I don't like flies buzzing in my face either. Or mosquitoes biting me or something. So we don't have to do some sort of extraordinary demonstration of uniqueness or something. I mean, just let the bliss be the bliss, that's all. If the bliss is there, we have done an extraordinary job. That's the proof of it. Okay, if the bliss is there, that's the proof of it. So that's the only way we need to be great, is let the natural proof be there. Okay? Just let the natural proof be there. Ramana Maharshi was extraordinarily adept at that. He just let the natural proof be there. He didn't need to prove it in any other way. So that is what is key. That is what is key. So we're still taping here, and the tape counter is not has not gone. It's still going. I mean, we're still taping, I presume. That's great. Presume. Maybe we want more cowbell today. It's required. You know, the world is, the anger that's being channeled in the world is just extraordinary. We don't want to do that. It's very tempting. It feels good because it feels like we're getting somewhere. Somewhere our voice is being heard, right? Like it feels like we're can be great. Yeah, we can be great. But again, the bliss is not even great. It's beyond great. So we really need to be beyond great, and bliss is the proof of that. We didn't choose to be great. You see, greatness is a belief we chose to be great. We didn't choose to be perfect. We are perfect. God created us perfect. So bliss is the proof that we've accepted. You know, we repented, actually. Truly repented. And accepted what we are. Yeah. All right. So, we're just going to full stop in the wow. I'm just seeing, is this, what is this? Is the counter going backwards? I don't get it. Funny, so it's, we've gone over the ordinary time that normally takes 4 gigabytes. And we're way down in the gigabyte thing, way, way down. It like shows we have like another hour or so available. So I'm not trusting this entirely. Let me see what happens here. Another pragmatic situation is just trying to struggle with technology, which is really quite... Oh, okay. It did go... Counter did go up. Just one moment here. I want to do something here. Hold on. You see, we can do that too. If you need to deal with something, you can deal with it without freaking out or anything. So it's not that we made the right choice, it's that we recognize there isn't any choice to make. This is the heart of truth. This is simply the truth. There's no heart of the truth, so it really, I mean, this just is the truth. this just is the truth. And we're still taping. Wow, extraordinary. I still don't trust the software, you know. It gives you false assurances, doesn't it? Technology gives us very false assurances. Oh, sure. This will work great for you. And after years of struggling with all the bugs, says, oh, well, bugs, really? What kind of bugs you having? Oh, yeah. Okay, let's see if we can fix this one. Oh, yeah, this will work great. You having problems? Oh, well, we have a new product out that, you know, is better. That'll work great for you. Get that one. Problems. Oh, yeah, we have another product out. This one, you're going to love this one. Oh, it got hacked? Oh, well, we got a new product that you're going to like. There's no problems with hacking. It'll be great. it's just a trail of false assurances. You know, we got to stay interested in this play, you know, until it's finished, until we're, this other will dominates and defeats and destroys the other one. One destroys the other, and then we'll be happy, we think. Finally, we'll be able to be happy. Now, of course, when you're taping outside, you get all sorts of bugs and things, right? But I'm pretty impervious to that. You know, just especially at night, there's just bugs flying, hitting me in the face, flying all over the place. Just don't worry about the bugs. We don't have to make a right choice. We just realize that there isn't any choice to be made. Never has been. We didn't get rid of the choice. We don't say, what happened to the choice? There was a choice there before, and now it's gone. What happened to it? That's the fallacy of the rope and the snake. Like when we see it's a rope, we say, what happened to the snake? Where'd it go? There's never been a choice there. So it's not like when we see there's no choice, we make the mistake of saying, uh-oh, I need to find out what happened to it, because it might come back. What did I do to get rid of it? I don't know, I'm scared, I don't know what I did to get rid of it. Okay, we have to be aware of this, that this is, you know, a mistake. We didn't get rid of it. We're just seeing it more clearly for the first time. We just desired that there be a choice and imagined that there was, but that God didn't go along with that at all. So there has never been another choice. Maybe if the video is just like white and black, maybe it doesn't use as much storage space. Whereas if it's in color, it uses a lot more storage space. Maybe that's possible. I used to think if I just didn't move, it helped. Well, that might. I don't think it helps that much. I may have to do with if it's just like white and black, mostly. Maybe that has something to do with it. I don't know. I haven't been able to find out. Just sometimes it goes longer, very, very rarely, but sometimes it will. I haven't been able to find a correlation necessarily. A little bit capricious, whimsical. Again, it's not that we make the right choice. So therefore, how can we arrive at the right choice? How can there be a path to the right choice? How can we attain the right choice? How can we recognize the right choice? How can we achieve the right choice? There isn't any choice. I'm out of water. Well, just a tiny little bit here. Wasn't expecting to go into overtime here, but here we are. Going to get hot in a few days' time. Meanwhile, we have this weather that is so incredible that I can't really describe it. People are commenting on it. It's like bright, clear, fresh summer sun, and it seems like it should be hot, but it's not. There's a soft, cool breeze, and it's just like 82 or something. I mean, it's just like hard to explain. But it's like wow weather. But this is going to change in a few days' time. There's a massive high pressure ridge that's going to push in here big time, and the temperature's going to rocket up. See, Tuesday, by Tuesday, they say, 103. Tuesday, Wednesday, 103, 104, around like that. Now, they may be sensationalizing it, maybe not, but it's going to be a week of heat coming up very soon. So, but right now, it's like indescribably perfect weather. Everything looked different yesterday too, and today, it's like it's autumn, but it's in summer. It's very amazing. I mean, it's still July. Last week of July, I think it was the 25th today. Yeah, 25th. But it feels like it's like October or something, and yet, you still have the light of summer. It's just wow, like a warm autumn day. And yet you have a lot of it. The climate is giving us different looks, isn't it, these days? And it's all, actually here, it's wonderful. It's been absolutely wonderful, except no rain. You get summer and winter, and you get autumn and summer. Sort of the seasons are kind of mixed, and you get that sort of a blended taste blend of the seasons now. I recognize that yesterday it's like working, and I said, I should be really hot, should be baking, and the sun's still so blazing and it's so bright, but I'm not at all. It's fresh and has this fresh, almost like autumn freshness and crispness to the air, and yet it's the summer blazing sun. I said, wow, what an interesting juxtaposition here that is. Now we're just containing the wow of this video. This video has been, again, pushed into new territory of intensity. I did some graphics last night that also pushed into a new area of intensity as far as beautiful graphics. I mean, the most beautiful graphics I've ever done and I've ever seen. I mean, as far as evocative graphics, I mean, it's just astonishing what happened last night. I prayed to the Holy Spirit. I said, I have some time to do graphics, but I don't know how to transcend what I've done already. I just don't see how it's possible. And through just the grace of the Holy Spirit, I managed to do this, and I managed to do that, and before you know it, it was done. I was really quite shocked by it. I don't know how to present it. I'll try it somewhere. I don't know what to do about it. It's just, it's almost like too good to present, you know. That people will miss it, you know, and say, oh, but, I mean, it's just art that I hadn't seen before. And I did how many pictures? 144 or something. And each one is just like, in itself, is enough to just be just, wow. That's good enough right there. It's just something holy and majestic about it. You know, it's just, wow. Now, again, the problem is, I say, I don't know how I can top this ever. You know, it's just, I think this is it. But I don't know, you know, how do you keep topping yourself? I don't know. It's just have to try to go big. And this is the challenge we have right now, is to go big every day. Go big every day. Go big, and every day in this video right here, I've gone big. I've topped myself. The previous videos, this tops it. You just have to believe that you can. You know, just believe that you can top what you've done previously. I have a Facebook page. There's a link to it. I don't even know what the name of it is. But the link is in the description below this video. I put links, and then on the banner on my YouTube video page, the banner there has, on the right, it has links to, and the Facebook page, I believe I have the right link there that goes, I might make double check it, that goes to something like Jesus is Back updates or something like that. Yeah, Jesus is Back. Anyway, you click on the link, you go there, and under photos, the menu of photos beneath the banner there, you click on photos, and you can see some of the photos I've up, you know, some of the photos that I've not photos but art graphics that I've uploaded to this Facebook. Facebook allows you unlimited uploads, so, and then you can click on, double click on one, and then it'll open up like full screen or kind of slide viewer mode, and then you can, you know, click on an arrow on the right, and you put your cursor on the image. Arrows, right and left arrows, will pop up on the image, and you can click right or left and go to the next picture if you want. But the problem is, it's easy to get overloaded with this stuff. You know, it's like one picture. Sometimes just one is enough just to look at it. You know, I don't want to overload people. I don't really know what to do about this. Guys, let's ask the Holy Spirit. You can download them. You know, you can download, you can work with the artwork. And that's one way of letting it get into you, is you can work with the graphics yourself if you want to. I don't want to limit people. I just public domain them, you know, and you know, some people might want to abuse it, some won't, right? If the people abuse it, they abuse it. But if those who, what I'm after, are those who, you know, want to get free, you know, to recognize their freedom, and they will use it appropriately, you know, eventually, in one way or the other. So I don't want to put some authoritarian control trip on people, you know, feeling that they're going to mess up. Well, some people will mess up for sure. I mean, there are screw ups around, and everybody's stuck, and so they'll express that stuckness in some way. But the Holy Spirit will help them use it and say, well, let me get, I can use this to get unstuck too. So I don't know. But certainly you don't want to overload people. You can get overloaded with it. You remember the wow there? You need to full stop on the wow. Now, if I just dole one out at a time, you know, some people want just one a day. I could do that too. Every day, make a posting on this web, on the Facebook page, and every day have a graphic there. But I also could have all the photos there for those who want that, you know. if they want to do it that way too. So there's options that way. And some want like photo of the day, a graphic of the day. And they could just check the Facebook page every day. And you can like the page and maybe, you know, comment on it and stuff like that. Now, I do have a regular Facebook page, but I found with Facebook that when you friend people, you end up getting all the garbage that they like and you know, that they share. And so your feed just becomes full of a ton of stuff. And a lot of it's stuff you really not interested in, actually. And for me, you know, none of it's, I'm not interested in any of it, actually. Not that I don't want to friend people. It's just that they, you know, they have like hundreds of friends, and they'll like something one of their friends has. When they like that, that like, you know, pops up on your feed. I guess you can control that, what shows up on your feed, but then that gets into all this bells and whistles and stuff, and you know, it's just a drag. So having like just this page that, you know, the Jesus is back updates, page updating what Jesus is doing now that he's back. You know, you just go to that, and that doesn't have all those friends, and then you can comment on that, but it's not going to throw all your whole feed of everybody else that you're sharing stuff with. It doesn't jam it all up with all that stuff. Now, there is a tremendous variety. I mean, Facebook can be very entertaining, just like Tumblr or Facebook, but it's also a great distraction, very great distraction, great way to waste time. Yeah, we don't want to waste time here. We understand that we're being pushed into waiting for this play to reach its conclusion, the triumph of this other will, which doesn't work. And waiting for happiness is a real drag, very, very miserable. So we're focused here on and going vertical. Okay, we're really focused on going vertical. And very few people in the world are really focused on going vertical. And they might have faint intentions, sure, but they're so stuck that all the stuff that they're interested in resonates with their stuckness. And then you start paying attention to that, you know, you're going to feel stuck too. Maybe this is it on the video. No, it's still going. It's still going. Okay, this is amazing. So, you know, this is the problem. So by having this page on Facebook, anyone can follow this page and check in anytime they want to. But it won't have all this garbage on it, you know, that resonates with stuckness. It's supposed to resonate with unstuckness. So feel free to visit and check out the graphics. I mean, you may be truly astonished. I haven't posted yet the full extent of what I have, what I did yesterday. But, you know, for some, it may be quite astonishing, quite beautiful, really, really quite beautiful. In a simple way. Some graphics are busier than others. I find that the super simple ones sometimes can be the most profound, actually. But there's nothing wrong with busy ones also. You know, that meets the eye in a different way. So you can pick and choose the different albums. I don't think you have to be a Facebook user to look at a Facebook page. I'm not sure, but I don't think so. Maybe you do. I don't know. I don't want to sign out of Facebook because I can't remember my sign in email or anything. I just leave it signed in all the time. I I can try it out somewhere else on some other computer. Go, maybe somebody knows. Do you have to be? Do you have to sign up to Facebook to view a Facebook page? If so, that would be no good then, because I wouldn't. It's no good. Don't want to force people to sign up for anything. Just winding down here a little bit. Because this information has been quite shocking. My body, mind, psyche, you know, the overall feel is quite stunned. In a positive way. Not stunned into like a traumatic way, but positively stunned. Like wow, in a wow way. And again, so if you want to go class half empty, you will actually then start struggling with it, and then you'll think you're going into trauma, nervous breakdown, panic, all this kind of stuff. So it's super important to, whenever you're listening to spiritual content, to take the glass half full approach. This is called the mood of repentance. Glass half full approach, and I'm going to look at it as a positive light of wow. The shock is a very positive shock. Glass half empty, arrogance will say glass half empty, and judge, and they go horizontal then, and then they can say, I don't need to go, wow, that's a cult, you know, that's some sort of cult, they're being positive all the time, glass half full, they're thinking, I gotta be more judgmental, discerning. Well, of course you can't make progress when that happens, so you just have to. You can make determination of what you're hearing, and again, it's only letting you know, truth speaks for itself. So just listen to the truth, and that'll give you the wow, and you'll know that's legitimate. When truth speaks to you, your own truth, the truth of the will of God speaks to you, then you know that's legitimate. You say, wow. So I keep doing this because I know it's legitimate. I feel this wow feeling. It's not an emotional feeling. It's not a cult-like feeling at all. It's not an idolizing feeling or worship or idolizing or anything like that. But it is in order to feel it, you have to go glass half full for sure. In other words, don't analyze it. Don't judge it. If you go glass half empty, say, no, wait a minute. You know, and start thinking about it. I'm not sure. How does this lead to success? How is this going to lead to success? How did I get here? How am I doing this? And then you get in your own way. You get in your own way. So you have to get out of your own way. And of course, the ego says, well, that's a cult. You'll fall into some sort of cult or something like that. You know, and ego tries to scare you into saying half glass, half emptiness. But again, you recognize it's your own truth. It's truth speaking to you from within. That's what you're hearing. Truth is speaking for itself. You know, anyone external is just reminding you to let truth speak for itself to you. It's okay. And when you say, wow, you're acknowledging, you're letting truth speak to it for itself. And it's not the teacher speaking, really. It's you're hearing, you realize the truth is within you. You know, that's what's, and so the wow is you're not paying any attention. You're not trying to relate to the teacher, whatever. You just wow. You're responding to your own recognition. Teacher's just a facilitator of the wow, of wowness, really, is all the teacher does. Just coaxes you, guides you, helps, reassures you. Yeah, it's okay. Go into the wow. See it. Take a look. Take a look for yourself. Don't just look at the words I'm saying. That won't help. Take a look what's being referred to. Let it in. Let this clarity in. Let, you know, experience it. That's why there's a distance between the teacher and those who are listening. There has to be a distance. You cannot, you know, get all huggy and stuff like that. I mean, maybe bhaktis can do that, but then it's easy to be, you know, start, you know, thinking that it's the teacher, what they're saying is what's important and giving you the wow, and not your own glimpsing of the truth. And then you make an idol out of the teacher and worship the teacher, and then you do have a cult. Unless it's a bhakti situation, you know, so it's hard to judge. It's hard to judge. You know, a genuine bhakti can have more interaction, so to speak. But here, it's not like that. It's not like that. So there needs to be this clear, you know, barrier, so to speak, where you're not trying to idolize or worship the teacher at all. You're just trying to get the courage to look with that the truth that is present. And so it's your courage, your looking, your wow, your truth. I mean, it's there for you. It's true speaking to you, within you. And the teacher just says, yeah, it's true. Truth spoke to me. It will speak to you. And this is how, you know, you can do it. This is where the focus and emphasis, the teacher helps set the emphasis, you know, and keeps, as you go horizontal, bring you back to vertical. Say, hey, you know, try to go back to vertical. Come on, try to go back to vertical. Like that. So we're not all huggy and bhakti-like here. No. That would be trying to be something that we're not. And the idea that bhakti is the way or something. No, it's a way. It is not the way by any means. And it easily gets confused with the play that we're engaged with, where we're making the feminine dominate the masculine, and then ultimately crush and defeat it completely and triumph over it. And then the end of the play, and then we'll say, okay, we won. Now we're happy. We had this will. We created a will that's greater than God's, and finally triumphed over God. It's easy for bhakti to sort of get the boundaries get blurred. Because a lot of the feminine is about hugging and being emotional and, you know, affectionate and you know, this kind of stuff. Bhakti, you know. And so it's very easy for the two to get blended and confused and that kind of thing. But a pure bhakti can deal with that. You know, a teacher that's a pure bhakti can deal with that, but there's certainly a lot of dealing they have to do. And today it lends itself that there can be a lot of fake bhakti teachers too, because it's easy to think, oh, we're on a spiritual trip here, where it's really just this play of this, where this will, you know, this will is now going to be dominant and crush the other will, so to speak. And it's easy to go along with that and thinking you're being very spiritual if you adopt sort of a bhakti approach where, oh, I'm hugging people, I'm telling how much I love them, you know, yeah, I love you so much, I love you too, we're so happy to be together here on the path. And there's an enormous amount of that going on in the world, you know, and it's just, you know, you just have to wonder, you know, how much of that is legit and how much of it is just this the ascendancy of this in this play of wills, two wills, the ascendancy of the feminine will to a position of dominance. You know, it's, to me, it's a lot of that, a whole lot of that. There's nothing in anybody, any male or female, that says they have to be a bhakti. The idea that women have to be bhaktis is nonsense. A lot of women are very mentally polarized and can, you know, look at it the way we're looking at it. You know, it's a stereotype to say that all women are just heart, emotional, kind of blah, 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 all these qualities that the feminists say women are this way. That's a complete stereotype. You talk about stereotyping. Nobody does more stereotyping than the feminists about this is the way women are, you know. No, it's not true at all. But women think they need to fit this stereotype. I need to be emotional. I need to be from the heart. I need to be tolerant and accepting and flexible and pliant and inclusive and compromising and, coming to consensus. I'm a consensus builder. I understand, I'm more feeling and all this. No, that's just part of the dream. That's just part of this play. Yeah, that's the actresses are playing, are just pretending all this stuff, actually. There's nothing inherently about a female body that makes it that way at all, really. So, there's a lot of this spirituality, New Age spirituality, which is really female dominance. And it's very prevalent on Facebook, prevalent everywhere. It's astonishing. There's all these sisters just relating with one another like crazy. Oh, I love you so much. You're such a beautiful goddess. Oh, I love you too. You're this wonderful goddess too. And we're like, oh, you're so beautiful. What are you wearing? Oh, I just love that. It just shows the radiant spirituality that you are. And what they're doing is they're building up this will, the idea that the goddess, triumphs over God. At least it certainly walks like a duck. Looks like a duck, quacks like a duck, swims like a duck, it's probably a duck. Because they're not really getting to, this verticality, unless they're, genuine bhaktis, which is possible, but it's easy to disguise, right now, it's easy to pretend to be a genuine bhakti and not really be one. So I like to take it the safe way here. I like to eliminate all that stuff. No bhakti here, okay? You want to say hello to someone, just put your hands like this or shake their hand or just a bow, just like a, this kind of, just greeting, that's enough. None of this touchy-feely stuff, we don't do that because, again, it's a very slippery slope. In the climate of today's culture, it's a very slippery slope. And the fact is, women can be icily determined, just ruthlessly determined. This emotionalism can give way to some ruthless determination, which is completely unfeeling and uncaring for others that they want to triumph over. See, this is the interesting thing, right? You see all these, oh, I'm so feeling inclusive, except someone else that I don't like, and then I'm absolutely ruthlessly suppressive of them. So they're not real true. That's not a true bhakti at all. Not a true bhakti. So a lot of this bhaktiism is not true bhakti at all in the world. A true bhakti does not act like that at all. True bhakti is wonderful. Absolutely, I love true bhakti. A true bhakti is wonderful. How can you not love a true bhakti? All love. Just all affection, all love. Yeah, who doesn't love that? That is great. But again, much of bhakti, what's going on in the world, is not true bhaktism. It's feminism. It's get this other will to triumph over the will of God. We're acting this out as a play, and it's very ruthless to those that it's crushing. It's very ruthless, extraordinarily ruthless, vicious. So again, we're not going to play that game. And a true bhakti wouldn't be bothered by that at all. You know that? They'd say, wonderful. God bless, wonderful. You do what you're doing. Thank God, that's needed. Just like Ramana told me, you do what you're doing. It's very needed. It's going to be great. Now, he wasn't really a bhakti, right? He was a yani. He can't even say what he was, really. He's just abiding on the edge of the great bliss perfectly, what can you say about that? You can't even, don't even define it. To me, defining Ram Maharshi is to damn him by faint praise, by faint explanation. He was just right on the edge of great bliss. So, There's a lot of pressure, a lot of pressure to go bhakti for any teacher, and we're resisting that here. We're not going to do it. Because that pressure is really coming from feminism, which is, again, this play, a purpose is to make this other will crush, one will crush the other. And men are playing, are acting out as if they were representing the will of God. It's just representing it for that purpose of the play. You have a protagonist and an antagonist, right, in a play, at least the play we're doing. And one ends up turning the table and flipping the tables and triumphing over the other. It's like, it's drama, it's play, it's theater. And what I've experienced is most of this so-called bhakti, feminism, mother goddessness, is ruthlessly suppressive and wants to crush anything that isn't that, so to speak. So it's not true bhakti at all. It's fake. It's fake. They're just wallpapering it with spirituality, what they're doing, to better draw in the male component, you know, to trick it, to deceive it, thinking, oh, we need to go along with this. It's very spiritual. It's okay. It's very spiritual. It's not. It's not at all. Not at all. True bhakti would be like Ananda Maima, for instance. Well, she could be anything, you know, Yani, bhakti, whatever. But it's easy to confuse that right now in the world. Very easy. So I don't use her as an example. I don't bring her into the situation because it could easily pull you into bhakti. And then you could easily think that feminism is some wonderful. Oh yeah, it's wonderful. This is great, you know. And it's bhakti. And then say, and realize, oh my gosh, it's not bhakti. It's dominance. It's triumph. It's vindictive triumph. Empty. It's not happiness. So we'll just have to do without that bhakti component. Bhakti here. That's which is fine. Which is fine. I don't feel I'm being deprived of anything really at all. They try to make you feel like you're being so deprived. All the gentleness, the kindness, the affection, the warmth, the tolerance, the acceptance, the goddess. Oh, you're so deprived. No, I'm not. I'm not deprived. Just because I'm not focusing on Ananda Maima, I'm not deprived. Jesus is just as good a teacher. He's a perfect teacher. I don't feel deprived at all. Oh, but you don't have the feminine, you don't have this. No, I don't feel deprived at all. Not at all. Well, we'll abandon you. We will cut you off. I don't feel deprived at all. You can't cut me off from bliss. You cannot be cut off from bliss. There's no choice. I just need to see that there's no choice to make. That's it. Are we still going? This is amazing. Yeah, we are still going. Awesome. So you might find that you like this, you know, you like this. I say, I like this. And you think, oh, but I'm being deprived. Maybe I'm being deprived because, there's not all the beads and the get-up, you know, the bhakti get-up, and not dancing and jumping and hugging and laughing and having fun and joy and all this kind of stuff. Oh, I'm missing out, I'm missing out, I'm missing out. No, you're not. Because getting to the goal of recognition that there isn't any nothing to choose, that results in the wow, and that results in the bliss. That's what you want. You don't want to think you're happy. You don't want to think you're getting to happiness. Oh, I'm bhakti, I'm getting to happiness. No, you want to recognize that there is no getting to it. There is no choice to make at all. And you will experience the wowness of this. So it's way more important to abide in the wow, full stop in the wow. This is the fast path, okay, than it is to try to act out the wow. Oh, I need to hug somebody. Let's all hug each other, you know. It's better to be silent. It's better to be just still and silent and feel the intensity of the wow and just abide in that and prove to yourself you can do it bit by bit. Because the bliss is very intense. Because there's no blockage to it. There's no achieving it. See, so it's just pure. It's pure, it's fresh. It's pure, it's fresh. There's no attaining of it. You didn't make a right choice to get it. It's just pure and it's fresh. So at least now, I don't want any bhaktiism to arise around this situation. which means the flowers and the music and the dancing and praising and all this hugging and stuff. No, I don't want, not at this point, you know. Now, I don't know. I keep an open mind. I just realize that there's potential for that to be extremely dominated by women, which is the ultimate goal of this play we're engaged in, which you certainly don't want to get caught up in that. Once you start introducing those elements, you know, then those who have sort of, you know, can fake it really good, you know, easily draws in those who say, oh, I can do that, great. Here, let me do all these flower arrangements. I can set it up as good. And they become the handlers, you know, the entourage, the handlers, and then, you know, the whole thing spins out of control. So at this point, no flowers, no music, okay? None of the bhakti stuff. We're stringently not bhakti. We're not anti-bhakti, but we're stringently avoiding not doing bhakti, okay? You call this jnana, if you want to call it yo-jnana, jnana yoga, Christian contemplation. You might say that like the bhaktis in Christianity are like the evangelicals. They're like the Christian bhaktis, okay? And, Protestants are more jnani. I mean, they're very, very austere, you know, very austere. It's not Mother Mary to them, it's Saint Mary. Okay, big difference. Big difference. So we don't do the Mama Mary thing here. Saint Mary, sure. No reason to suspect otherwise, really. I mean, give the benefit of the doubt. There isn't any, I mean, there's some, you know, oral tradition that Mary was an apostle and a saint. It's not conclusive, but, you know, benefit of the doubt, why not? But Mother of God, no, that's part of the play of that we're engaged in the female dominance, actually. A mother, really? So God has a mother? That the mother gave birth to God? This is the whole play, idea of two wills. It's blatant. It's absolutely blatant. But we don't need to dwell on that. You know, it's better to keep it, okay? Because dwelling on it pulls you into the bhakti-ness of it, you know. You don't want to do that. You want to keep this pretty neutral. I try to use, you know, be fairly neutral, but make sure that when you do use pronouns, it's the male pronoun to prevent you from, for one thing, to prevent men from feeling they're being absolutely crushed. Men are actually so crushed right now. They feel they can't, the only way to salvation is through feminism, through women. That's it. And so they're getting into all sorts of relational things with feminists, you know, with women. I say, oh, they're not feminists, they're bhakti. You know, oh, yeah, sure. Right. Okay. Big difference, you know. It's still, they feel that they have to get happiness through women. It's the only way. And there's so many men that are crushed. It's very important to emphasize that this whole play of another will is totally bogus. And to keep a sense of balance about it, let's make sure that we use the male pronoun. We say God the Father. We don't say God the Mother here. We say God the Father. Pragmatic. It's a pragmatic help. Ultimately, God, there's no gender at all to God, of course. But this is a pragmatic help here. The situation here is like a wildfire. Completely out of control wildfire. You might say the planet is burning. It's absolutely on fire with this goddess worship, actually. And this is ultimately designed to, quote-unquote, crush the will of men, the will of God, symbolically. They're trying to crush the will of God symbolically, and males are playing the symbolic role of embodying the will of God, the Father. And the purpose is to crush this, completely destroy it. And a lot of people are not listening to anyone who's not a woman right now, as far as spiritual teaching. If it's not a woman, or if they don't have a co-teacher who's a woman, they won't listen to it at all. It's off the list, because I think they have to get, happiness has to come through women. That salvation comes through women. This is the teaching, New Age teaching. Salvation comes through women. It used to be, well, it comes through balance of both, but they've long since abandoned that, long since abandoned, because that never was the purpose at all. And if you look at it carefully, you say it's absurd. You only get confusion in such a situation. When you're talking about authority, what meaningful authority can there really be if it's equally shared authority? There's no authority, real authority there at all. There's no real will there at all. Will means this is the way it is. And if you have two different wills saying, this is different, I say this is the way it is, you say this is the way it is, and it's different, how can there be any will there at all? It's an illusion of will. It's an illusion of will. So, of course, we're not satisfied with that, and we go towards dominance, having one will, which we think we want to defeat God's will. So we have to have a victor here, and the way that it's structured here is women who are going to play the role of the victors, the conquerors, the champions, the winners. So that's why so many men are feeling they've got to go through. You look at spiritual satsangs, various things. I mean, the women are completely dominating the situation, and the men are just like wallflowers again, just like, I hope you get it. You know, I hope you get it. Cheerleaders, like, come on, you can get it. And I can't be happy until you get it. When you get it, then you're going to make me happy. I'll be happy because I'll know my place, you know. I'll know the true will, what the true will is now. We'll finally have a singular will because you defeated the other one, you know. That's basically what men have been reduced to now. So, you know, I think a lot of people, you know, won't listen to me, for instance, whatever I say or will say, because I'm a man. You see, they say, well, truth can't come through a man, it has to come through a woman. The true will can only be expressed through a woman, and that's the only way we can get it. This is what's happening. But so I'm not going to have some co-host, a female host, say, okay, let's balance it out, let's make sure we have you there. No, that's just playing the game. That's just playing this stupid game, and we've already done that, and we see what happens. And those who have done that, the women end up taking over, for sure. One way or another, or a coup d'etat of some sort. They're vicious about it. You know, they'll accuse you of improprieties, they'll accuse you, you said this, you did this, you know. They'll try to induce you into some sort of behavior that then they can attack the behavior, you know, attack the messenger, and before you know it, you're deposed and they're in charge. This happens over and over and over and over again. That's their purpose. It's the purpose of this play that we're, you know, stupidly engaged in. But again, it's a stereotype to say that women have to do it through bhakti. Complete stereotype. Very, very nasty stereotype. It's not true at all. And they, you know, pulled out the carrot like, well, women have an inside track on, well, they have an inside track in this play, which is the whole thing is designed for women to triumph, of course. So of course they have an inside track on the script of this play. It's written that way. But they don't have any inside track on realization at all. Neither are they on the outside. Neither one. So don't stereotype. That's judgment. They can do it this way too. Anyone can. This way or that, you know. It's full stop in the wow. Anyone can do that. And the problem, the temptation for women, the reason why they have problems is they know in the script they win. It's scripted for them to win. So they say, why should I put all my eggs in the basket of this yani approach or this approach, you know, of full stop on the wow, when I know I'm going to win in the script and then I'm going to be happy, right? And we say, no, you're going to be absolutely miserable. So that's the temptation. So women tend to not get after it as much as men historically because they know deep down that the whole thing is scripted for women to triumph. And so they say, well, all I have to do is wait. And if I wait long enough, I'm going to be a winner. But of course, reality is not anything you win because there's no choice you make. There's nothing you need to do at all. Believing you need to do something is losing. Is you will not be blissful as long as you think there's something you need to do. Including winning, including triumphing, including overcoming. All that stuff is scripted as a play to delude us, to distract us away from the inherent nowness, inherency of what we are. There's absolutely nothing we need to do to be what we truly are. That all is designed to distract us away from this. So I'm getting paged here one moment, okay? okay, so we're still in the world, you know. And you know, the people of the world, the women of the world, and the men, because keep in mind that the men believe in this script too. That's why they're going along with it. You know, it's not like it's the fault of the women. It's the fault of spirit. You see, men believe that they need to go along with this, so they are going along with it. So both are to blame. You know, if you want to blame, it's just equal blame for this. I'm just not going along with the script, you see. That's the only difference. But yeah, it takes two to tango, really. But you know, the way things are, men and women will believe you have to go along with the script. It's the only way to happiness. And if you don't, you're going to be unhappy. And they think that they need to help you be happy. So they say, oh, I need to help you. I want you to be happy. So of course you have to go along with the script. It's the only way to happiness. This is duality. This is the insanity of duality. So you're in the world, and you're going to run into this constantly, right? And that makes you go horizontal, doesn't it? Instead of vertical. And you say, oh my gosh. So you just do the best you can. And be grateful that there's help. And I thank those who have expressed gratitude for the help here. That's great. That's great that some are being helped, you know, and recognizing that there's some who recognize, you know, that's really tremendous. It's an expression of their own clarity, that they're listening to their own truth, you know, and they're getting glimpses of it, and they realize it. They say, oh my gosh, you know, this there is a way out. Oh my gosh. Now I'm seeing it. Oh my gosh. You know, that's great. Thank the Holy Spirit. Thank God, the Holy Spirit. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Give thanks to that. Absolutely. Otherwise, we would certainly be lost in space, wouldn't we? So, yeah, it is the again, it's very important to emphasize that it's one thing to point out clearly what's going on, which I have done with this script. And it's another to clarify, I'm not blaming the women exclusively. It's the men are also going along with the script. They're like, oh, I'm overpowered. Oh, I'm so attracted. Oh, I have to go along with you. Oh, yes, I'll do this. And the women say, wow. Okay, I need to say, yeah, I am a winner. I am great. I am the goddess. And the men say, oh, yeah, you're such an amazing goddess. I really feel so happy with you. So it's both that's going on. I mean, men don't have to be crushed, actually. Although it seems like they do. I mean, the script is demanding it of them, but they don't really have to be crushed. Like, I'm not totally crushed. I don't know how crushed I am or not, but I'm trying not to be. Socially, I'm still crushed. I mean, I cannot bring this out socially. I mean, socially, I mean, the men are just, I mean, the roles are very clearly defined right now. Not just the men, but the women. I mean, the roles are extremely rigid and strict socially in the world right now. Not all cultures are, but it's global. It's really global. I mean, I meet people from all races, all places, continents, you know, and the women are the same all over the world right now. They're very much into this role, very strict, very rigid, that they're the goddesses and they're the ones in charge. It's everywhere. And the men are very much into the role of serving the goddess. You know, it's global. It's a global script. And again, both are to blame, and ultimately, it's spirit's arrogance to blame for trying to change the will of God. And spirit is, it's also spirit's ignorance. It thinks it needs to leap directly back into reality, when in fact there's an intermediate step that the Holy Spirit has provided. So once spirit realizes there's an intermediate step, then it stops realizing, hey, I don't have to go along with this script. I don't really have to go along with it. I have a way to get back to reality. I have a way to be happy. I do have a way. It obviously, this script is not going to give me happiness at all. Obviously, I know that. So, thank God there's a way. I don't have to try to leap straight back into reality. When we speak about spirit being ignorant, it means it's ignorant that there's an intermediate step. Because in reality, of course, there aren't any steps at all. There's nowhere to get to. When we're having this dream, you know, of trying, we're engaged in self-deception, there is this intermediate step. But we're not naturally aware of an intermediate step. It's something we need to be told, actually. We need to be clued into it. Otherwise, we won't think about it. We really will not. We think it's all or nothing. I think we need to leap straight back. Otherwise, there's no other way. So that we do need to be told about this. That's why I said Christianity, the gospel, has to be shared to all the world. You know, the good news that there's this intermediate step. But once we find out there is, then we say, "Well, wow, yeah, I like that. Thank God, there's this. You know, I can, instead of pretending to be dead, I can pretend to be eternal life. I don't have to drop all pretending. I don't have to drop it all at once. I don't have to do that." Because this is what we're terrified of. It's the terror of dropping pretending all at once, including all the witnessing to pretending. That's what then binds us to the script. Makes us feel we're bound to then go along with the script, and thinking that's the only thing that offers any possibility of happiness, is to defeat the will of God. And the script acts it out symbolically for us. There has to be triumph. That the lesser needs to triumph over the greater, at least the ones that pretend to be lesser, you know. So you have to start out with the protagonist, you know, seeming to be lesser, and then they can become equal, and then they become greater. That's how the play has to play out. That's exactly how it's playing out. But once we realize there's this intermediate step, we don't have to play that, go off that script anymore. We say, "Oh wow, I can get a reflection of bliss. Yeah, I can, absolutely, the great bliss. Yeah. Tremendous." And so this is what's all important. Most people are in extreme ignorance in the world. They don't know there's this intermediate step. This is what Jesus brings to the world and teaches us. Tremendous, tremendous help. Essential help. Now Jesus says this is the easiest way. He said there are other ways, so to speak, where you can work at it, where it's not, doesn't seem so directly, but it takes a long, long time. It's very difficult. But he says, by just looking at this directly and saying, and accepting there's an intermediate step right up front, then this makes it way easier. Way, way easier. And the benefit of this now is a lot of us don't want to go along with the script. The script is getting so insane. There's a lot of us that say, "Hey, it's too much. Forget it. I want something else." That's what I did. I said, "Hey, I'm not going to go along with this anymore. Help." And then I got this information that there's an intermediate step. And so this speeds up the path immeasurably. So really, right now is a great opportunity for those in the world to speed up their path immeasurably, because there's so many who are looking at this future of this world and say, "Oh gosh, I really don't want to go there. I'm not going there. Forget it. Forget it. It's just sickening. It really is sickening." I mean, the roles that men and women are playing right now is just, they're horrible roles. Absolutely horrible. Both of them. I call them the men's roles, you know, pajama boys, you know, and the girl, pajama girls. Pajama girls and pajama boys, you know, just, "Oh, come on." You know, no way. No way. I'm not going to play those roles. It's just sickening. I mean, you look at it, it just, you want to barf, you know? Really. On the radio, just the voices, the way they talk now. The tone, the whole tone, of the entire situation just makes me want to barf, just throw up. Sickening. Sickening tone. Oh, my God. It's so pathetically, obviously acting. It's all such obvious ploy, you know, theater. You just say, "Oh my God, you're just overacting so bad. It's just terrible." Everybody's overacting, horribly overacting. It's like a movie when you suddenly realize everyone's totally overacting. And it just ruins the whole movie, right? Really, this is what's happening. And the movie's ruined for me. I can't believe it anymore. It's just, the overacting is so extreme. I can't take it. You know, but when you think, when the actresses, actors are doing a great job and they're underplaying the role, right, then you go along with it. But once, you know, once they goes over the top and they're struggling too hard, you know, to convince that this isn't the movies. Like let's imagine if an actress said in the middle of the movie, they say, "Hey, psst, go to you, you know, side, you know, the audience. Hey, audience, this really isn't acting. This isn't the movie. It's really true, you know, it's really true. Yeah, and you believe me, it's true, because I'm telling you, and I'm so beautiful, and I want you to believe it, that it really is true, right? You know, that just ruins the movie for you, doesn't it? I mean, it's ruined, because you know, obviously, you know, oh, it is a movie I'm watching. It's the ones who underplay it, you know, so underplay it, you think, "Oh, I'm just watching like some reality show here. This really isn't a movie." this is reality, you know, they underplay it. That's the genius of the great actors, you know, and actresses. Is it's like they're not even acting, not even trying, you know. It's just that they're not, you know, but to get out of movies, that's just an example, but the whole world is overacting right now. They're absolutely overacting to just an extreme extent. An extreme extent, they're overacting. And we're realizing this, oh my God, you know, this ruins the whole movie for us. It, I can't believe it anymore. And then it becomes repulsive. It becomes very repulsive. But it's more like you want to throw up, you know, that kind of thing. You just want to, you say, nah, stay away from me. Of course, the feminists say, "Well, if you don't keep going off the script, you're gonna turn into a terrible rapist." You know, that which they're trying to intimidate you, force you to keep, you know, believing, "Oh, this script's great, this movie's great." But no, you, it's sickening. You just want to get away from them. You know, stay away. You don't feel like a rapist. You say, "Just stay away from me, please. I don't want anything to do with you. Just stay away." That's how you feel. You know, they're flattering themselves, you know, to think otherwise. They're just trying to flatter their acting job. They say, "Oh, I'm such a convincing actress that if they don't like, you know, the next thing is they'll want to rape me because I'm such a convincing actress." No, we want to stay away from you completely. Stay away from me. This is sickening. You know, stop. I want to get me out of this movie. I want to leave the theater. That's what you want to be. I don't want to keep watching the movie. I want to leave the theater. So that's just, you know, their extreme demand, the dominance that, you know, you can't leave the theater. You must commit crimes. You must keep watching the movie. Even if it makes you commit crimes, you must keep watching it. You know, that kind of thing. Say, no, we have an option. We don't have to keep watching it. We don't have to commit crimes. We don't have to keep watching it. We don't have to do what you say. No, they say you must play the role of evil now. You must be play the evil to give us reason why we must crush you. You must act in this evil way so then we can claim you're a terrible, dangerous person and you must be crushed. You know, that kind of thing. I say, no, we don't have to do that. I experienced that once. I've told you before, and the lady got very angry at me. Very furious, you know. She said, "I want you to be this evil person so I can play the role of a victim and then I can then have the right to crush you and destroy you." And I said, no, I'm not going to do that. And she got very, very upset, you know. Blew her, the whole role, the whole script was blown, you know. Didn't work. And this is what's being scripted now. Like, you know, men are being told they have to be these, act out, you know, violently and act out in ways which then justifies, you know, crushing them. You know, that kind of thing. Oh, men are so evil, they're so bad, they're so terrible. These men are just acting along the script with the women, you know. It's all scripted this way to give the pretense for women to, you know, crush and dominate men. And it's not, the script's not going to change. You see, we just don't need a script at all. Reality doesn't need a script. It's unscripted, actually. So we just say, "I'm not interested in this, you know, this isn't the road to happiness. I know where happiness is, and there's no road to it. It is right here, right now. There is no choice I need to make. There is no right choice I need to make. Therefore, why wait? You know, I can experience it right now. It's not a choice I make. It's a choice that I don't need to make a choice, you know. So I don't need to wait for it. It's here now. So this script is what we think is going to lead to happiness. It doesn't. It doesn't. So we just say, don't need you anymore. Don't need it anymore. Sorry, don't need it. Not even sorry, we don't need to apologize. Why are people so embarrassed if we don't apologize to them? You know, that's the question that needs to be asked. Why are all these pajama girls and boys so embarrassed when we don't apologize to them, you know? They act like, "Oh, why?" Because it's not in the script. They say, "I don't know. That wasn't in the script, you know." They go cry to the producer, you know, Mommy, that someone went off script. Gotta punish them." And we say, "Oh, go ahead, Mommy, go talk to God and tell God to punish us. Please do. Hurry up, too. Don't keep me waiting, because I'm not going to wait around for my punishment. Sorry." Yeah, that's another thing that I've emphasized. We're not going to wait around for our so-called punishment that the goddess insists for going off script. She's going to punish us forever, a lasting punishment. We're not going to. I said, "Well, you want to punish me? Punish me right now." I tell them, "Well, not you. Tell God to punish me. She got no authority over me whatsoever. So yeah, tell God to punish me, but I want the punishment to be right instantly, because I'm not going to wait around at all for it. I'm accepting bliss right now." That's the way you have to deal with the situation. We can't be stupid about it. You know, you can't be bullied into the script. Don't be bullied into the script. I know there's some who are trying not to be bullied, for sure. And I'm just coming up with some advice here that I see as very helpful. Just say, yeah, agree with your adversary quickly. Yeah, you want to punish me? Great. Tell God to punish me. You can't punish me. I want real punishment, not fake punishment. If I deserve punishment, I want real punishment. And real punishment can only come from God. There's only one will, one true will. That's God's will. So true punishment could only come from God. So if I deserve true punishment, let it come from God. And if I don't deserve true punishment, then get out of my face. Plain and simple. You're just a deceiver, right? If you don't think I deserve true punishment, then you're just a liar and a deceiver. And you're just demanding I go on some script for fake happiness, you know? So that's the end of the story. You're finished. That's it. You know, just say to God, you know, okay, yeah, go to God. I deserve true punishment. Let me have that true punishment right this instant. If I don't have this instant, it's not true punishment. And so, oh, I didn't have it. Okay, you're a phony. You're a fake. You're just trying to pressure me into going back on your script for really unhappiness. And so, no, I don't need that. I have a way that actually works. So we're done. We're done. We're finished. You're done. You have to deal with it that way, really. You just have to, you know, give some tough love to the scripters, you know, the pajama girls and pajama boys. You got to give them some tough love. And they'll, you know, again, they get so flustered. I go cry to the goddess, hey, they're not behaving like they're supposed to on script. They're off script. Punish them, punish them, punish them. The goddess says, don't worry, I will punish them severely. And they come back to say, hey, the goddess said she's going to punish you severely, but I'll make a deal with you. You know, if you just go back on script, I'll go tell the goddess she won't punish you. And I say, no. If I did something wrong against the will of God, then truly, I want to be punished. I deserve true punishment. Therefore, true punishment can only come from God, because there's only one will. And only the will of God is real. Nothing else is real. Therefore, and the punishment would be instantaneous, because there's no time in God at all. So go tell God to punish me. And then you don't have to say anything more to me at all. Once you've done that, that's all you need to do. Because if I'm not punished, that means that you're just a deceiver. And a liar and a deceiver. And you're trying to trick me back into a script of unhappiness, which I completely reject. I'm within my right to absolutely reject that, because I know the true way. Okay? So we're done. That's all. You need to say, we're done. And then I'll go scream. You know, see, they try to intimidate you by that, saying, hey, the goddess is going to punish you, but I'm going to make a deal with you. This is how the goddess trains them. Say, go tell them that the goddess is going to going to punish them severely. But to say that you have the authority to make a deal and say, hey, you know what, I'll make a deal on the side. I won't even tell the goddess. You just go back on script and I won't say anything more. I'll just, you know, she'll forget about it anyway. You know, that's the way she is. She's very forgiving, you know, very forgiving. I have to remind her all the time that someone's going off script. That's what the goddess trains, you know, the script. That's how they're trained.